The views expressed on this Turnbuckle Tabloid live stream or Turnbuckle Tabloid podcast episode do not reflect the views, thoughts, or opinions of the Rageworks brand, including the Rageworks podcast network, Rageworks content partners, advertisers, and affiliates. Viewer and listener discretion is advised.
You're listening to a wrestling podcast where the two hosts are cool as hell, but haven't been laid since Hulk Hogan was a champion. You're listening to Turnbuckle Tabloid.
Turnbuckle Tabloid.
3, 2, 1.
Day 849.
We're about there, right? We're
still dealing with quarantine.
Are we really?
Not really. We just quarantine ourselves.
New York's kind of slacking right now.
No, actually, we're actually opening up a little bit more. Gyms are going to be opening up.
Are you going to trust that?
No. It's at
33%. I'm still going on my track, dude. I'm going to stay on my track. I don't need to worry about going to the gym right now.
I wasn't really a fan of going during my time anyway. My gym is...
Before COVID?
Yeah. I wasn't really good. Because I only would go after work. So I'm like, nah. And it's always packed. So I already know what it's going to be like going in there now. It's going to be...
It's going to be unreal.
There's going to be a line to go into the gym.
And I'm not doing that.
No,
it sounds
no.
like Black Friday for weights. It's going to be an absolute mess. So.
We basically just be sitting there like, yo! We good? We can come in now? What's up?
Well, now I feel like it's going to be a thing where it opens at 8 or something like that, and people are going to be waiting outside like for a Funko Pop drop to reach.
Oh, Jordans. It's going to be the Jordans just to get on the treadmill. Like, dude, you can walk outside. You good.
Because that's why I go on the track, because I had to get comfortable with the track, because I know even when it came back, I wasn't going to trust the gym. I don't want to see Sheamus doing the weights and shit like that and then having to give everyone COVID. You know?
Well, at least when it comes to, for me, I just realized that my gym... It's going to be opening up across the street from my job, so I could go on my breaks.
Oh,
and I could
just
do that or whatever. Rich, you going to the gym?
No gyms have opened up yet here. We got an announcement last week that said they're going to open them on the 24th, but it's going to be dependent on the government, the state, well, in this case, Nassau County,
right,
agreeing that the gym meets certain standards.
Right.
So...
You mean to tell me you're not gonna be in a bubble on the fucking doing fucking leg presses and shit?
Honestly, I think what they're gonna end up doing is, well, I go overnight,
right.
So according to what they said, it's gonna be 33% capacity.
Yep.
Yeah. So there's basically not gonna be anybody there anyway.
Right.
If they go overnight. So
yeah. If they stay open 24 hours and I go 2-3 o'clock like I normally go,
right,
I should be fine.
Sweet deal.
But working out with a mask is what's going to be interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I actually saw some videos of people working out like in Pennsylvania because the gyms are open over there, and they say the same thing. I can't keep that shit on my nose when I'm doing.
Yeah, put that. That Bane shit. You gotta put that shit like Bane got on. It's like you embrace the darkness. you gotta put that shit.
I guess
on.
If you want to pass out, I don't know. I'm gonna stick outside for a little bit,
guys. In case you haven't noticed, we're in the studios of the big boss himself, Big Rich. We're in here. The cavemen are out. We're actually in modern times these days.
Yeah, wow.
Yeah, look at all the accoutrements that's around here. It's like,
unreal.
Shit. I feel like I'm in Hot 97.
Do you?
I'm an ill rapper. Where's Rosenberg at? I got that Rosenberg.
Kissing WWE's ass.
Yeah, right? Yeah, we're getting there. But
I think he's done with them, actually. I haven't seen him on a product in a while.
I think he's hit. I think he's like
he's on and off.
He's on and off. Just like on Sam.
So. I see him on sports stuff more so.
No, actually, he was on the. If I'm not mistaken, he was in the pre-show.
He's
doing the pre-show.
I'm pretty sure him and Sam Roberts are doing.
Yeah, because he still has those weird fucking jackets and shit.
He did the pre-show for Extreme Rules.
Right.
And
he had the
the Ric Flair Mark jacket with the PR.
Right,
the Peter
right,
Rosenberg.
Right. So I mean, we're here at RageWorks Studios. I'm telling you, I feel like Diddy's gonna walk in and like sign me to a contract.
Think about what Peter Rosenberg
will be on Title.
Wow, that's saying a lot.
Matter of fact, yeah, shit. I forgot. Title's podcasting, right?
Title is supposed to be podcasting. I believe that that's going to be the one of the next outlets.
Oh, okay.
Amazon is going full steam. Spotify has made people step up so much.
Really?
Yeah.
Because they've bought three companies. They paid Rogan his deal.
Right.
And they scooped another company. Spotify owns Anchor.
Oh, okay. That's what it was. Right.
Yep.
Yeah, I also heard that Spotify threw a lot of money towards Howard Stern's way. Is that true?
Well, it's
I heard they threw him a big deal.
There's discussion on either Spotify. Pandora has a deal with SiriusXM as well, right? I believe that they have. I think SiriusXM bought them.
Yes, they did.
Yeah, so Pandora is definitely going to be heavy in that market as well. So that might keep Howard there. So he'll get that joint deal.
But look at this, even the thought about Howard Stern going to like a podcast network. Out of all things he said about podcasts.
Listen, he's got to change. Everybody's got to change.
Everyone's got to evolve. This is what I'm saying. Even in the wrestling business, people, you have to evolve. You have to.
Listen, during this COVID time, like we were talking about when we was on our way over here. Like, listen, you got to step up and take those innovations that you have, those thoughts that you have, the creativity, and push them. And Howard is at home right now in the Hamptons doing it.
And is he a germaphobe? So he ain't going anywhere outside the house?
He ain't going nowhere, shit.
It's like Howie Mandel?
He's like fucking Howard Hughes and shit. He's running fucking locked in to make sure no germs or fucking parasites in that
shit. Well, you know, Howie Mandel is such a germaphobe that he hasn't left his house since COVID. He has people going out getting food for him, and people thought he was kidnapped. Because he's
no, I can imagine. I can imagine he'd probably been like in a scuba outfit and shit going on the streets and shit.
Someone on TikTok like went outside to go see if he was home, and he came out with a glass shield with the arms going out of it, like you were about to touch a newborn kid.
Yeah, I'm telling you.
Yeah, it's like
listen, these days, look, I've come to the realization, and I said either you've had it, you're gonna get it, or you're just gonna find a way to avoid it. It's gonna be one or another, but.
You're immune.
Like I said, I was tested. I had the I was asymptomatic. Right. I said at one point I might have had it, and I was like, I never had any ills or whatever. So I'm.
Well, I told you I had a really bad.
I'm
really,
mutant. I'm fucking Wolverine. Whatever.
Like Deadpool or some shit.
Yeah, exactly.
I had a really bad flu in February, and I look back at it, and I'm like, yeah, I'm pretty sure I had.
Nah,
early,
you just had the runs.
I had pre-COVID or something like that.
He just had the runs.
Because I don't know if you remember, but like I said a few episodes ago, there was a run where everyone was getting the flu in February. Everyone. It was like at my job, everyone was calling out. It was bad, and I went into the doctor's office, and he told me that I had the flu. And he yelled at the receptionist because no one in the office was wearing a mask.
You had AIDS. That's all it was. You just had AIDS. You had a short.
But if I knew that, I would have done different adjustments.
But look at what's happening to you now. Shit, you're losing the weight.
I'm trying.
You got fucking. You pierced your ears. You see this shit? He pierced his fucking ears. Look at that.
I'm trying.
Real
bro.
Gavone over here.
I'm real Gavone. All I need is the bling and the chain, and I'll be all right.
Yeah, that Guido chain. That's all you need. What are we gonna get? We're gonna get
step
the,
at a time.
The Saint Mary. We're gonna get
Oh my god. My mom asked me that yesterday. She was like, "Would you ever get a chain?" I was like, "But like." I feel like chains are meant to have sentimental value. Like, I feel like my dad has a chain for his grandpa.
Right.
I don't have that. Like, I don't have, like, my
you're
dad.
Gonna the, you're going to get the Cuban Link bracelet?
No, my bad. My dad's going to pass down his UPS retirement watch. Exactly. I have to wear that shit.
The gold watch?
The golden watch.
Yeah, the trickle down effect.
Which he waited for years to get. But it's just, I'm trying, bro.
Matt gets his earrings by a recommendation from his mother. I'm telling you, this kid,
My mom was like, I was
"You look good with earrings. I'm telling you, you look fine. Get the earrings."
I never thought about it. So I said, "Fuck it. If I don't like it, I take them out."
All right, Mr. T. Look what we got over here.
That's it. Can't get wrong with that.
Yeah, might as well.
You have ears pierced?
My mother pierced my ear with an ice pick and an ice cube.
That's the old school shit. Yeah,
I remember. Wow. My grandmother was on a trip, and I remember she had said, "Oh, you know, he's gonna pierce his ears." No. She was gone. I remember she was like, "We're going to take this little thin point of the ice cube of the ice pick and make a slight hole. And then I'm going to run a sewing needle through it with thread and then tie it." And I had a piece of ice on my ear for like 20 minutes
to numb that shit.
And then she did it. And my grandmother came back. And she was screaming, "Oh, my God, I can't believe it." And then, you know, you start making the earring the accessory. Yeah. So I, absolutely. My mother got me like a gold one with my initials, get the Puerto Rican flag one, get the loop one, get, you know, the weed leaf, because that was the thing back then, everything, all these different, I had a bunches upon bunches of different ones.
Wow.
And, you know, walk out, that was a thing. And
typical Hibaro, I swear.
Yep. Yeah. So that became the move for a few years. And then, like, one day I took it out and I didn't put it back on and it just closed. And I was like, all right. You know what? I stopped wearing it when I started working in an office environment.
Oh, okay.
Because I got self-conscious. That and I'm just like,
look at the typical spick with the earring.
Yes. Yes.
Wow.
I know. I was telling Matt that I still have, I can still feel where the piercing is at. And I said,
the lump, the little lump on it. Yeah.
And I said, periodically, I used to do it years ago, but I would bust it open, like by myself, and just break it open and go back in it again. So I was like, ah.
Well, you already told me, once I get this, the healing shit, you're going to take me some toys.
Yeah, you're going to get you some studs. We're going to go earring shopping, girl.
Ooh, I'm so excited.
We're going to get you some fabulous.
My dad,
series,
my mom was like, "If you come home with gauges, I'm kicking you out of the house."
Oh no! Nah,
I was like, "I ain't doing gauges. Don't worry about it."
That's actually, but it's good. Listen, you know, you're a young man. You're like going through the mood. That's what it
like
is.
Like you said, like 5 minutes ago about COVID. Like, if you want to try something, this is the time to do it. So I mean,
yeah, might as well. Fuck it.
What the fuck's what's gonna happen?
Yeah, but,
at this stage of the game, with everything going on, it's like everything is up for grabs.
Yeah.
Because you know what? It's like nothing at this point is surprising.
Yeah, no,
meaning, like, if I wake up tomorrow and they said, "Hey, a monster came out of the ocean and destroyed Tokyo," I'd be like, 2020, folks.
Yeah, exactly.
That's it.
Right, fucking
next, that was the next level of Jumanji.
Yep. Exactly.
I feel like we're living in Jumanji. Exactly. Real. It's like the next level. The boss fight is going to be whatever.
Just make sure you get me a one up, man. I just got to get a one up.
One need a one up?
I need a one up.
Listen, I'll figure it out.
Welcome, everybody, to another episode of Turnbuckle Tabloid. I am your host, Mr. Ear to the Mat, the King of Talk Style, and as always, the Cheap Thrill, Jay the Red Santee.
And I am the Mook with the mic, Matthew Olskey.
And sitting in with us, like I said, is the boss himself, Rageworks' own Rich. Rich, what's good, buddy?
Hey, man, what's going on? I'm so glad to finally have you guys in studio. As we've discussed off air, I wanted to try and get some of the team members to do shows in the studio, use the equipment, get familiar with it. So I'm glad we got to do it, even in this COVID climate.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
I'm glad we did it.
Since you can't see us, I'm in a yellow outbreak suit right now. I got the CO2 and the H2O going in and out.
I know you stole my gimmick, bro.
Yeah, I know.
It's like, the same thing.
I was actually going to wear my Darth Vader outfit, but I was like, nah. Too much. It'd have been too much.
Yeah, extra. It's a little too much.
Make sure you check us out on all the social media outlets. Check us out on the Like group page on Facebook. Numbers are growing week by week. On the page is the announcement for the first ever Turnbuckle Tabloid Fantasy Football League. So, guys, participate, be a part of it, join up.
Can we just make it quick? Like, come on. Every single team has to have a wrestling gimmick name. And if you don't, you can't join.
I mean,
it's a wrestling football league.
Listen, I already got a guy in there who's called the Muffin Man. I'm not going to deny him that.
You know what he could do? Tell the Muffin Man to edit, change the name, and press the confirm button because.
Well, you know, join the league and then you could, you know, help to push the trend. My team's name is already called the Hitman. So
I'll go on live tonight and be like,
I have the Bret Hart logo.
Name, you're donezo. You need, the Nakamura, the artist.
The artist.
Stupid shit. Like.
Yeah, I mean, whatever. We'll see what happens. We just need participants. That's all it is.
Is it almost full?
Yeah, we need a little bit. We need just a little bit more.
That's what's the prize? Like a Turnbuckle Tabloid?
A night with me.
The winner should get one of those homicide shirts.
It should. We could do something
like that.
Because
that's limited edition. No,
I did last year for the other league. I designed a specific league shirt. And plus, I'll get one of those replica fucking belts, those cheap fucking Walmart belt
on Etsy.
And slap a Turnbuckle Tabloid sticker on it.
Fuck it, make it work.
With a button. Just make it get a button on it. It's like, there you go, you're a champ. There you go, winner.
Wow.
Make sure you check us out on Instagram at Turnbuckle Tabloid Podcast, as well as on Twitter at
Turnbuckle Tab.
Make sure you check us out as well as on Get Vocal and on YouTube at Turnbuckle Tabloid. Get Vocal, guys. Get the app. Watch us there every Saturday at 5 p.m. Enjoy our Around the Square Circle discussions. Yeah. Be a part of it. Join in. And, yeah, you guys have a good time with us. Maybe I'll be drunk. Maybe I'm not. Who knows?
Hey, Mark, where you been, bro?
Yeah, where you been at, Mark? We miss you, bro. Also, make sure you check us out at all the podcasting outlets. Get us at iTunes, Spotify, Google Play Music, Apple. It's Apple Podcast now, right?
Yeah, iTunes is Apple Podcasts.
Yeah.
So you guys are there. Google Podcasts, Spotify.
And we finally finally got the Pandora deal, huh?
The Pandora deal for the network is in. Once it's officially up and running, then Turnbuckle Tabloid will be in there as well.
All right.
Exactly. We're touching bases. Finally, the Pandora deal is possibly
now we're only
in play.
One.
Now we're missing one. Are we missing?
Which is?
Black Planet.
Mi gente.
I was going to say porn.
J-Date.
I was going to say porn, but it's all right.
Paul, you porn? Still working on it.
Still working on it, ladies and gentlemen.
And, of course, if you can't get us there, you could always get us at RageWorksNetwork.com. RageWorksNetwork.com is where you get all the shows that are under the RageWorks umbrella. Black is the New Black. Call Me When It's Over. Toys and Tags. Why miss any episode from us when you could go right there as well to get it at RageWorksNetwork.com. And also at RageWorks.net. RageWorks.net is get the reviews, previews, upcoming events, whatever the hell is going down in the culture that we do it for. You get the comic books, TV shows, movies, video games. It's all covered at RageWorks.net. Yep. RageWorks.net, ladies and gentlemen. We do it for the culture, baby. Pop culture, that is.
Yep.
Speaking of pop culture, like I said, before the mics went on, I was talking about Muppets Now.
Yeah, that's what you're doing.
Listen,
right?
I needed a break because I was on social media.
Well, politicking.
Oh, I had to give up.
Political analyst Santee is without a doubt my favorite Jay Santee alter ego.
Yeah, fuck the Matt Hardy guys.
The many faces of Santee. As soon as Santee says, come on. And I go up. Here we go. And you know what the scary part is? As a New Yorker, as somebody who's lived through essentially you and I have lived through three eras: the '80s crack era, the '90s gentrification era, the Giuliani era, and then now the De Blasio circus era.
Yes,
You know, New York City is a place where, listen. If you come in here with some preconceived notion that New York is like what you see in the movies, it's not.
Exactly.
And it's the complete opposite of it.
And that's the problem. The problem is that New York is so diverse. There's so many different aspects of New York. And on top of that, New York is so segregated within its own within its own borders. You know, Brooklyn has its own culture versus Queens versus the Bronx versus Manhattan. Yep. Everything is different. So for guys like Jay and myself watching the city essentially eating itself right now.
Exactly.
It's crazy. Lawlessness, all of the stuff.
I'm just waiting for the last scene of the Joker. I'm just waiting for that. I'm just waiting for that last scene.
Well, we kind of had that a few months
back. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
We did have that a few months back when Manhattan was essentially burning.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like we wanted to, what is the was it Batman Arkham City when they locked down the whole fucking...
The only thing that was missing was Joaquin Phoenix. We're on point.
He's basically just to lock it down.
There was a guy walking around dressed like the Joker. I believe in one of the protests, he was walking through.
Oh, no.
And they got a photo of it.
The funniest I saw was a guy walk. I think it was in Pittsburgh. The guy was walking through the smoke bombs that they were throwing, the police were throwing, and he was dressed as Batman.
Yep.
He was prepping for that shit. He knew already
I'm just tired,
that guy got canceled because he was like pro cop. They found out like a week later.
Really?
And that's the thing, you know, like the cancel culture phenomenon.
Yeah,
it's weaving its way through everything that we know and love, from sports to wrestling to... And some of it is justified, some of it isn't.
Right.
You know, and it's a scary thing, especially once with pro wrestling, there's so many skeletons. Like, people are like, oh, this person committed this sexual assault. And it's like, and you're shocked. Why?
This has been a thing in the business for quite a while.
Well, that and the fact that, you know, you get young men like Matt who's coming up and they have, you know, this preconceived notion that we can make a better life for ourselves, and it is the youth that we want to have to make this movement. But then I hear the youth who are just as fucking negative as the next one, and I go, you know what, guys? I mean, we're fucked. Seriously,
it's unfortunate,
we're really
because
fucked.
All I'm hearing on social media lately is just negative. Just negative, depressed reviews of everything sucks. No one's happy.
Well, it's hard also because we are also under. You got to think about it. Some of us are still locked down.
Yep.
The majority of us are, you know, there's an unemployment rate which is astronomical.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Kids can't go to school. can't play in the park.
Yeah.
Can't do this, can't do that. I mean, Jay can vouch for this because, and you too, Olskey, they took down basketball hoops.
Yeah.
Yes, they did.
Like imagine not being able to, as a kid, to go outside and play.
Unbelievable.
Fuck that. You know, I grew up in the projects. We took a milk crate, tied it up on the backboard, and did it. We did it up.
Of course, but
they make it work.
We did it.
We were also innovative.
Exactly. We were creative.
You know how many people, how many age groups don't know how to use tools?
Yeah.
How many people don't know how to cook? How many people don't know how to do some of this stuff? So the expectation is X. And in an era where YouTube is around, it's like, yo, you should know how to do this stuff because there's a video for damn near
everything. Fuck the University of YouTube. You should learn everything.
Like Isaac said, YouTube is probably one of the most resourceful learning tools that we have access to nowadays.
Yeah,
you can learn how to do anything on YouTube. There's a video for everything.
Get a fucking scholarship to YouTube fucking Academy and shit. Fuck it.
Present's not a thing.
True.
Yeah. So, guys, this week on this week's episode, we have cutting a promo this week is the comparisons that were drawn on social media this past week between the WWE, I believe it was like the 98 to 2000
era and AEW
today. That was a conversation that came up, and I was a bit perplexed and confused.
I scratched my head at most of them.
Yeah. So I was like, okay, we'll discuss that in cutting a promo this week. Also, we have, of course, as always, Wrestling Rundown. We discussed what was on Wrestling Rundown this week, sir.
Wrestling Rundown had to do with Velveteen Dream's accusation.
Right.
How Triple H came out saying what everyone was wondering, what the fuck happened there.
Right.
We had the unfortunate news of Lars Sullivan possibly making a comeback.
Jikers.
Yeah, that. We had Thunderdome reviews from the announcement of that being done, and just other gossip and bullshit in regards to Renee Young leaving WWE, you know, the whole nine. So
we have around the square circle. We go through our review of what we saw, what we have this week. I have a great book for you guys to check out, man. I've been listening to it for the past week or so for me to basically just separate myself from the political shit, the politicado,
right,
that Jay Santy had to pull away from. I had to sit down and get an audio book. It's a really good listen to. I'll let you guys know about that.
Listen, I'm about to buy it myself after the shit you told me.
Yeah.
It sounds like a great great thing to listen to.
And we also have this week sitting down with us. We'll have first part of the conversation with, I guess, no longer that punk Isaac. Now he's going by his shoot. We're going to talk
Rodriguez.
To Isaac Rodriguez. Isaac Rodriguez is stopping in. He'll be discussing about his association and connection with VXS.
Yep.
Big, you guys, like I said, I applaud you because what you guys pulled off this past weekend, nothing short of a miracle.
And it's funny.
I would have been pissed. I'd have went home.
It's funny because I know, I mean, I help Isaac a lot with stuff, but he pulled me aside and said, I don't give a fuck. We're doing a show.
You were his Pat Patterson.
I was his Pat Patterson. Oh, for real.
Today is 100%. Very banana.
It's very banana.
It's very banana today.
It was an obstacle, I'll tell you that, but I'm pretty sure the product was mostly received well.
Yeah, so we discussed that and much, much more. So, guys, don't go anywhere. Stick around. We will return with Turnbuckle Tabloid. Take a listen to a new song by a friend of the show. Well, actually, his daughter.
Oh,
my boy Papito.
Oh, it's a classic.
It's a classic. So you guys don't go anywhere. Stick around. We will return. Check it out in a sec.
This is Grim Reaper, and you're listening to Turnbuckle Tabloid.
Give me a fucking mic! Turnbuckle Tabloid, cutting a promo.
Wrestling Rundown, ladies and gentlemen, brought to you by Olskey's Piercings. Come down to Olskey's Piercings, where you can get anything you want pierced.
Done
your
in 10
ears,
minutes.
Your nose, your lip, Olskey's Piercings.
Now taking nipple suggestions.
Now we're taking nipple piercings. Starting this week, we wanted to do something different with Wrestling Rundown. So actually, we wanted to discuss documentaries. And I was like,
right.
No. I think we're going to do more pulse talking about what's going on during the week a little bit.
Well, because you and me, we start off with conversations on the phone when you're at work, and all of a sudden we bloom into a deep conversation. We go, you know what? Fuck this. This needs to be cutting a promo.
Yeah, there's got to be a cutting a promo. So, like,
I'll give you guys a sneak peek. Most of our cutting a promos are off our conversations.
Exactly. Yeah, we're peeling back the layers, ladies and gentlemen.
Which I prefer. Because...
you're going behind the curtain. Shh. So this week we're discussing, there was a post on social media, I believe it was on Twitter, and even Dave Meltzer jumped up on it, the comparisons between WWF during the 98-2000s era, like the late Attitude era, to AEW. So, I don't know. Rich, you saw this? Did you get to see it?
I saw some of it that was shared in a couple of different, I think Sports Kita or somebody shared right. something, and I saw it on Facebook. And when I read it and I saw like a lot of the conversation surrounding it, I feel that this is the problem of how this game is played. The necessity to compare.
Yeah,
and I explain all the time, and it's cliched at this point. I tell people, I'm like, yo, the Attitude Era is legitimately lightning in a bottle.
Mm-hmm.
You got it once, it hit. You may never, ever, ever get something of that magnitude ever again. It was a perfect storm
right.
of talent, the acceptance of pro wrestling at the time, the vacuum that was created by certain promotions just fading out. So it became the Monday Night Wars. That was the end-all, be-all.
And then the fact that at that time, a lot of stuff was acceptable to go past. You could
exactly.
you could slide a lot of that stuff through, and nobody was that offended. You know, it took a high level of stuff for somebody to say, okay, slow down. That was a little bit extreme. Now, these days, as people may say, with the social justice warriors and the snowflakes out there, there's no way you could get any of that stuff passed anymore.
No kidding. I mean, we're like you said before in the opening salvo, it's time to evolve. You can't keep looking at the past to try to make success. I mean, I think the key to success is making a future nowadays. I mean, everyone loves a good nostalgia trip, but when it comes to the wrestling game, I don't think it's going to work.
You have to run down there who they had the comparisons to?
They want it so badly. They want, and I hate it. I hate when people are like, who's going to be the next Stone Cold? And my response is always, there is never going to be
no.
another Stone Cold.
But it happens in everything. It happens in sports. You know how many arguments we've heard? Definitely the LeBron and Jordan comparisons.
Well, but you know what it is? I hate it because, like, look at John Cena. John Cena's a textbook example. Everybody says, oh, he's trying to be The Rock. He's trying to be The Rock. No, John Cena's trying to be paid.
Right.
Now, if the journey takes him into that territory that it took The Rock, that's a different story. But people forget The Rock ate a lot of shit when he went into Hollywood.
Right. He had some stumbling blocks.
And he had some duds.
Yeah, he had like, some bombs.
Like a guilty pleasure I always watch when it's on cable is Doom. Right. He was in Doom.
Right.
You know, he was the Tooth Fairy.
Right.
He was, the list goes on and
the
on.
The game
on.
Plan.
Yep, yeah. The game plan.
Yep.
The Rundown, Walking Tall. Like, you notice the caliber of his work went up.
It was just basically Dwayne Johnson was Dwayne Johnson. It was nothing out of it.
Faster. Like, when he started
getting... Faster? He didn't even say a line in that movie.
I think he said, like, a handful, but that's what I mean. He started reaching that moment when you saw it and you were like, all right, he's starting to hit his stride.
But did anybody ever say... The Rock is trying to be Hulk Hogan? Because remember, that's what Hulk did as well.
Right, but you know what happened with Hulk Hogan? Hulk Hogan stayed in his lane, meaning Hulk Hogan either played like the big dude or he played like a comedic version of himself.
Right.
Hulk Hogan didn't branch out. Like, people forget that in the sequel to Get Shorty, The Rock played a gay guy.
Right, right.
People forget that.
Right.
People forget, when he was the football coach in that other movie with
right.
Exhibit.
Right, right, right.
You know, But that's what I mean. Like, he diversified his skill set along the way, that by the time he got to where he is now, people forget about the Scorpion King. People forget about the Mummy 2. People forget about Doom. People forget about all those movies, because now it's like Jumanji, Moana, you know, Black Adam.
Yeah.
Like coming soon. That's what people remember. The hits. Look at John Cena. John Cena's IMDb listing is all garbage.
Yeah, he's eating a lot of shit.
Have you seen The Marine?
Yep. But then he's in Fast and Furious.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, don't get me wrong. He's in Fast and Furious because they wanted to stick it to The Rock, but he's in Fast and Furious.
Yeah, and it's a level up. Everybody,
that's a big
level
role.
Up. That's a level up.
That's a level up.
Look at Triple H. Triple H was in Blade.
Right.
After that, he did a few movies, and then he realized this ain't for me.
He did a chaperone. Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
That's when WWE films were cranking them out.
See, but I feel like WWE especially like pulls their guys to the side when they get that certain age, or even like when their stardom is so great, and they go, listen, you can make some side money with some films. You know what I'm saying? So let's try out some WWE films.
Yeah, but
the Big Show has his own fucking TV show on Netflix.
But with that, there's only a handful of individuals in that world, because people say, well, all they're pretty much doing is acting. But yeah, there's a level of acting.
Mm-hmm.
And now
you have high expectations because of the shit you're doing in the wrestling business.
None of these motherfuckers is doing Shakespeare. I don't give a fuck what anybody tells you. you're not cutting a fucking Shakespearean fucking Hamlet fucking monologue. Cut it out. You're not doing that.
Right.
But a lot of them can, you know, they have that ability to, maybe they can break out and do something.
And a lot of people shit on the WWE films, but that's usually the testing ground to see who can make it in the film business. Who can
carry a movie. Now, here's a joke, and you'll appreciate this. How is it that Batista is considered a higher tier actor than John Cena? Think about this. If you look at it, Batista did a bunch of like straight to DVD stuff. Yes. He was in an action movie with Rob Van Damme.
Right.
But this is what I mean. But now, villain in James Bond, in the MCU.
Mm-hmm.
Like Batista, you know, he did Stuber. He's been all over the place.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And the thing about it is, Batista's now a well-respected actor.
Man. Yeah, he is. Now he's in that realm.
Mind you, he wasn't a big player. He was a player in WWE. He wasn't a big player.
Right.
But now he has the last laugh. And this is what I mean. Like, to sit here and compare that era with what AEW is going through, AEW is in a completely different bracket because the AEW has a big financial backer.
Right.
Number one, they have a front office that not only are players and coaches,
which kind of bothers me a bit, but we'll get to that later on.
The coach aspect?
Yeah.
Above all, they believe in what they're doing.
Right.
And that's the biggest thing. If you believe in what you're doing and you believe that you can provide a reasonable alternative, then everything is up for grabs.
Yeah.
And I like that when they interview Cody or I'll go one step further, when they talk to Triple H and they're like, oh, what do you think of AEW? He goes, hey, man, they're doing their own thing. I wish them nothing but the best.
Yeah.
Because those guys, no, don't get me wrong, they'll throw their little jabs in, but people don't understand that they do that for the sheets.
That and the fact that it's one of those things, once again, like we mentioned on our way over here, it was iron sharpens iron.
Yep.
Regardless of us being competitors, it can only make you better.
Yep. Big time.
So
absolutely.
What's the list that they had in the comparisons? Because I was like, we'll go one by one so I could go like, what?
The first one was that Dave Meltzer said that Jon Moxley is the current age Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Okay. I always goof and I always say on the show, whenever that happens, I go, hey, what the fuck? He's doing in Austin. This is what the fuck it is. He's our modern day Stone Cold.
He even has the ring.
Right. He has all that
he
shit.
Even has the Stone Cold ring.
Let's be honest here. There's no one that could ever, and we've made it mentioned before, that could ever do or did what Stone Cold did for WWF at that time or in any time ever.
A lot of people don't understand. Stone Cold's probably one of the greatest of all time for what he did.
No.
And this
company was going to fold.
Yeah,
it was close. It's going to be extinct. And what that gimmick and what that person, what he did, like you said, It's phenomenal.
Yeah, absolutely.
It was uncharted territory.
Right.
And I always joke, he made a chicken salad out of chicken shit. Because think about it. He was the ringmaster. He was stunning Steve Austin.
Yeah.
Hollywood blondes. The list goes on and on and on. But the minute he had his black boots, black tights, and that Austin 316 promo, that was it.
Yeah.
And that was golden from there.
Now to say for Moxley's in the AEW's in fresh. It's not in ruins. It's not problem. If you wanted to do a comparison, if you look at it, Matt, if you're looking at a comparison of who's a real fucking badass, when you put them two side by side, honestly, who are you going to look at and see as the badass?
Between Stone Cold and Moxley?
Yeah.
Stone Cold.
I had a debate last week about this. I still don't believe that Moxley's 6'4". I don't see.
I think the height is definitely wrong there. But here's my...
What I was going to say is, with Moxley, Moxley's chops, in terms of the wrestling business, Moxley endured a harder road.
Right.
Because he was doing the deathmatch shit, mm-hmm. the bloody shit,
CCW,
all the crazy over the top. And again, I'm saying shit not to say it was shit, but
just the things that he was doing.
He was doing the stuff that was unheard of. Stone Cold's career trajectory was ECW, WCW, WWE. Maybe some local shows.
Right. Yep.
But you weren't getting hit with fluorescent light poles, barbed wire,
right.
staples,
yeah.
really blood and guts type of stuff. So in that respect, I think Jon Moxley has paid his dues.
He paid his dues that way.
But I feel that in Moxley's case, Moxley as a performer is in his own lane. I don't feel that Moxley is a strong all-around performer. He's a good entertainer,
mm-hmm.
but he just doesn't captivate like Stone Cold did.
Well, that's
you got this guy drinking beer, middle fingers.
And that's the thing that gets missing, because the word is charisma.
Yep.
Charisma, yeah. Well, people are also saying that if you throw Jon Moxley a GM, like they had it with Vince, that it would be as equally as good.
No,
and I tell you, one thing that I don't agree with that at all, because I think the whole story of the fighting your boss has been so overplayed now.
Yep, you can't do it no more.
I think it died. I think it died actually a long time ago.
Right.
And they tried replicating it. And every time I've seen it, I just keep thinking, you're not topping Austin and Vince,
nope.
So what are you doing?
Right.
You can't do it. I think that we've reached a point where, as we discussed before the mics went on, you can't do that because it's just not going to work.
Right.
Moxley has to have something completely different.
Yeah.
Completely different.
Yeah, it's like you said, lightning in a bottle. When you got a charisma as Stone Cold, I mean, it was bigger than Vince even thought it would be.
Yep.
Yeah.
Remember, this is a guy who's gonna be Chili McFreeze, whatever the fuck it was.
Yeah.
And
absolutely,
it was an instance to where it got so big that people didn't even realize that what they were wearing was tie to a wrestler.
Yep.
You know, the apparel, just the way he carried himself, the lifestyle. People were,
it was relatable.
It was relatable, but it was also, think that even to this day, when you look at other wrestlers who try to like take a piece from it, you can never do that. It can never be replicated.
Well, that's why I love innovation and creativity nowadays. I mean, a lot of people give MJF shit because they say he's taking a lot of pieces from different guys, but I think he's made it into his own.
That was the other one they got. Yeah, MJF was compared to...
It was MJF compared to The Rock.
No. Nope.
And people said that, you know how they said for the other comparison that they would need, that Moxley would need a GM? They said that MJF needs a live audience to get there.
I would compare MJF straight up. I would compare him to pretty much anybody else but The Rock. but I say this... not as a negative,
right.
And I'll explain. MJF thrives on... if you're going to compare anybody to MJF, you compare MJF to Roddy Piper.
That's what I was going to go with.
Because
that's a great... that's great.
Because The Rock transcended wrestling. Like, The Rock became an institution.
Mm-hmm.
From his catchphrases to the way he dressed to the shirt. Hell, the shirt he had with the gold coins,
mm-hmm.
I found that shirt in a store. And I used to wear it to work.
Really?
Like, legit. Because I had to be dressed up.
Right.
So I'd have, you know, dress pants, nice shiny shoes, and the shirt with the little Versace-looking coins on it.
People were like,
that's a really nice shirt. And I'm like, yeah, well, because, again...
now I know why you took the earring off.
but that's what I mean. Like, when you look at that, that's what you have to look at. The Rock thrived because he connected with an audience on an entertainment level that nobody's doing. Nobody's doing. Not even now.
Yeah.
And nobody is going to connect. The closest, maybe, would be like a guy like Elias. Because Elias had a gimmick that allowed him to connect.
Yes. Right.
That doesn't mean he was going to be good at it.
Right.
I just felt that he was enough that the audience would finish his catchphrase. The audience would sing along. Right. The audience would participate. Elias was on his way.
And even when he shit, even when he was a heel and he shit on the audience, he could walk into an arena every week and go, let's see, who am I shitting on? The Chiefs? I could shit on your football team. I could shit on your terrible fucking pollute, whatever the fuck it was. He could find a list in every state he was in and go, I could shit on this and get a pop out of it.
Well, that and also, I've not seen face MJF.
Right.
I don't want to see
I don't think I want to see face MJF.
You want to see face Randy again? I don't.
MJF as a face should not even exist.
Right. It's like when
I see the same as Randy though. I don't want to see a face Randy.
It's like when I see him come out and he's a ball of fire. He knows exactly what points to hit. He's not gonna, but yet, like you said, there's nothing where he's like you could be part of him. Like the Rocky was like you said, the sing along with you're part of being with the Rock. You're part of that. Where MJF is like, he goes on, and it's like you said, like Piper. Piper would go off the shoe, off the mind, he's gone, he's done, and he'll fucking pop off.
MJF, honestly, and this is how I see it, MJF should never, ever, ever be classified as a heel or a face.
Yeah.
He should be an equal opportunity offender.
Yeah, exactly.
Because guess what made Stone Cold connect with so many people? Stone Cold was never a true heel or a true face. Until the Alliance and all that shit.
Which...
But even with his feud with Vince, when he tagged with faces, they'd get stunned after the match.
Right.
See what I mean? Because he was an anti-hero.
Right.
If anything, MJF should be an anti-hero.
Yeah, that's a good look for him, especially when it comes to doing this comparison with The Rock. It's like, who knows? Like I said, anybody could transcend to whatever. But with him, it doesn't have that same level of charismatic appeal.
Here's my question for you guys. In The Rock's career, he had to evolve. He had to change. I mean, Rocky Maivia was clearly not going over. He had to change his gimmick. And then once he went to the Hollywood scene, he went to the Hollywood Rock. Is there going to come a time where we have to worry that MJF is going to get a little stale? And he might have to do the Rock evolution, where he turns into maybe a Hollywood jackass, or he might like...
Maybe. It's probably going to be something like that.
Is MJF's character just being like the guy he is an ass, a troll, whatever?
Give him some TNT made-for-TV movies. He'll probably slide into that.
The thing with MJF, I feel, is that he stays in character.
He does.
Mm-hmm. So he relies on old-school tactics for a new-school audience.
Right.
Everybody's feels they're getting hit with a razzle-dazzle that he's doing something innovative and unique. He is not. He is doing Vader slapping the reporter. He is doing Macho Man on Arsenio.
Yep.
He is doing any other wrestler that does interviews in character.
Yeah.
That's all he's doing. Very few people that I know that I've spoken to that have interacted with him have ever got real MJF.
Not even Jericho on his podcast. No.
Even in Q&As. Even like in meet and greet pictures, like and shit like that, he gives the finger to the person.
He lives
the gimmick, and I think that's definitely rare nowadays because it's hard to.
Who else they had on there?
And the last main comparison we have here is Cody being compared to Triple H. And Dave Meltzer said it's because that he took Triple H and Cody had to go through the ranks of being shitty gimmicks with Hunter Hearst Helmsley and Gold and Stardust, and they ended up being the empires they are today.
To be honest with you, I'm going to say that that's actually a slap in the face to Cody.
I agree.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, no.
I'm going to say this. Stardust wasn't a bad gimmick.
I wasn't, to be honest,
I didn't mind it that much either.
The contrary, Stardust and Goldust should have been a thing where they should have had multiple tag team runs.
Yeah.
They should have had
the same way.
Plenty of vignettes, plenty of airtime, because you're never going to get more natural chemistry than chemistry from you and your siblings.
Mm-hmm.
It's never going to happen.
You're right.
If you are in a multi-sibling household and your parents and somebody interviewed your parents, they'd be like, my kids cut me up when they interact with each other. Yeah. Whether it's fighting, arguing, doing things together,
right.
funny gimmicks, funny skits. That's how it goes. And Cody and Stardust worked. The only problem that Cody had to endure was the fact that it was he was always pigeonholed in, hey, we're going to put you in a faction with other third-generation guys. Hey, we're going to put you here. Right. Hey, we're going to... Listen, Cody Rhodes, when he wore the mask...
Right, great, dashing, the great dash, gimmick. The dashing Cody Rhodes, yeah.
Dashing Cody Rhodes, paper great bags, gimmick. Paper bags, great gimmick. Him with...
the mustache.
Him with Orton and Ted DiBiase
legacy,
Jr.
The legacy.
Legacy
yeah.
gimmick. Solid.
Yeah, I loved it.
You know what I mean? Like, yeah. he never really had a bad gimmick.
No.
No.
Triple H...
Made a lot of money with it, too. Triple with H, merchandise and everything. Made a lot of money with it.
Triple H's Hunter Hearst Helmsley gimmick wasn't bad. The only thing Triple H had to endure was paying the price for the curtain call.
Yep. Yeah. That was the ultimate punishment.
That was it. And, you know, being having garbage poured on him with the Godwins, like, shit like that. But when you look at it, Cody Rhodes didn't marry the boss's daughter. Cody Rhodes doesn't run an empire. Cody Rhodes is self-made.
Self-made. Came up. Actually had the tougher road because, you know, remember, not only is his sibling in wrestling, but his father's probably one of the greatest wrestling personalities of all time. Wrestling-wise, if you're comparing... Triple H 98 to 2000 to Cody now, Cody is far beyond what Triple H was at that time.
Agreed.
Far beyond.
Agreed.
If you're talking about the mogul aspect of it, of what he has become, once again, like Rich mentioned, he didn't marry the boss's daughter. A little Triple H, not to take away from him because he has a keen mind, a sound mind for wrestling, the business practice of it, whatever. But Cody has leaps and bounds as a child to manhood. Shown that he's been connected with the business long enough to know that just like an MJF did, that you can take the old school ways, bring it to the now, and it's working and it could work.
I think Cody and MJF are the staples of that.
Like, certain just, things are just timeless.
Right. And like I said, I think that comparison was very unfair to Cody because
I think so as well.
And it's like I said, not to take anything away from Triple H, but that was no, that's not happening.
Another main one they had was, which you want to talk about siblings, Matt Hardy and Jeff, the Hardy Boys and the Young Bucks.
Which is an accurate...
I think that's kind of fair.
It's a fair assessment, but here's where the disparities lie. The Young Bucks grew up in an era of wrestling where they didn't have to be surrounded with the excess. They knew what could hurt them.
Mm.
They knew drugs, all of this stuff. The Hardys came up when, you know, taking somas and doing all the stuff right. They survived that era.
Yeah.
And that's what I always tell people. That's why Matt Hardy saying he's unkillable, it amuses me because it's like they were in an era where they got a lot very quickly and it should have adversely affected them.
Mm-hmm.
And it did in Jeff's case.
Right. He's like he's like the Ozzy Osbourne of wrestling.
Right.
Sure.
So when you look at it, the Young Bucks, they were smarter.
Yep.
They knew what mistakes can I not make? I got to make sure that my gimmick is sound, that I'm healthy. Like, you don't hear about the Young Bucks being injured. You don't hear about the Young Bucks being involved in any controversies. You want to know why? Because they looked at all their contemporaries and realized this is the shit we shouldn't do. That's why when they compared them to the Rock and Roll Express during the tag team thing, I laughed and I said, yeah. Because those guys, you know why those guys are still wrestling as senior citizens? Because they can.
Right.
Is it great? No. But they can.
Yeah.
They have the career longevity. And I'm sure, whatever, they might have had their boozy circumstances and whatever in that era. But guess what? They're still alive. They're still able to go.
Yeah. They're doing fucking tope suicidas out of the rings and shit.
Yeah, right,
and
exactly.
Code Reds and shit.
You saw that House of Glory. It was unreal.
The thing that bothers me about that comparison is, to me, many may disagree, but I don't take the Young Bucks as wrestlers. I think they're just very in-tuned acrobats who just know certain maneuvers. Honestly,
wow, that's a hot take.
The Hardys, these guys trained. These guys, you know, came up on that old school ways where
trampolines,
and then they got trained. They busted their ass getting into WWE underage at the time. But once they got into the system, they really fully learned how to become wrestlers.
Yeah, absolutely.
And as for the Young Bucks, I'm sorry, I just don't see them as wrestlers. I see them as just acrobats who knows certain holds.
I feel like because I watched a few tapes from the Young Bucks. Well, before they were called what were they called in TNA?
Generation Me.
I saw some wrestling there. I understand what you're saying now because I can sense on AEW that they do a lot of acrobat shit. It's mainly high spots, but in terms of the comparison, I don't know if you watched the Hardy Boys documentary. The shit they went through, they for sure grinded.
Oh, yeah.
To learn.
Yeah.
Do I know the Young Bucks documentary? No, but it's coming soon on AEW TV, ladies and gentlemen.
I guess
it's coming soon on AEW TV, ladies and gentlemen. But I understand the comparison, but like it's the way they were brought up is different, 100%.
The one comparison that came out of here was that I saw was Hogan and Jericho. Interesting. The Hogan comparison, because, you know, larger than life, highly charismatic, timeless. I could see that with Jericho.
But sure.
Jericho didn't have the work to having to make a promotion start small to make it huge.
Yep.
Hogan came in when it was about to be a wrestling explosion in the 80s, and he was the lighter who started that fucking explosion.
Well, I tell you to this day, I mean, my personal belief is I think Chris Jericho has done more for the business than Hogan, in my opinion.
Possibly.
In my opinion.
Yeah, possibly.
He's been everywhere. He's done everything. He's the whole AEW thing is just a small speck. He went to Japan and made that an absolute must-watch show. The only place he hasn't gone is TNA, but, I mean...
Who wants to go there?
Well, you got to look at it this way. In the case of Jericho, what Jericho did is that Jericho knew his strengths, and he made sure that wherever he went, he was not only bringing those strengths, but bringing value.
Right.
You don't see Jericho running around doing all the high spots he used to do when he was younger.
No, he even says it on the show. He's like, I'm not doing that anymore.
But he's a storyteller,
mm-hmm.
and he knows how to connect with being reinventive,
right,
and making that a thing. Like, he said Demo God in one promo. Next week, Demo God was in his video entrance.
Yep.
You know what I mean?
Seriously.
Sammy Guevara singing his music. Now everybody sings his music because it's what you have to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that in Hogan's case, Hogan was conditioned and groomed to carry a company.
Right.
Chris Jericho was always underutilized wherever he went. Mm-hmm. It wasn't until he planted his own flag that they realized, oh shit, we got something here. Because if you remember, when Jericho came to WWE, they were always saying, oh, Jericho's one of the little guys.
Yep.
Yeah, we did a retrospect on him last week. You know? And that's what it was until, you know, he carved his way and his way, because it wasn't, nobody modeled him. Nobody said, this is what we need you to do. He did it on his own.
Like you said, he debuted that night on Raw and
that was it.
And it was history. Like you said, Jericho was known in WCW, but the pop he got when he debuted, like you said you were watching it, and just the fact when you saw the scroll of Chris Jericho, that name,
yeah,
you knew something was going to happen. You knew magic was about to be made.
But you also look at,
not a lot of people could say that.
You also look at, you know, when you look at Hogan's run, fine, say your prayers, eat your vitamins, you know, drink your milk, whatever the case may be. But Hogan really only had two solid runs in his career.
Rock and wrestling and NWO.
Right. Two solid runs. Lucrative, financially amazing, but do we not see what Jericho, like you said, has done for the business in 20 years?
Yep. And not only in just WWE or WCW, it was everywhere.
Yeah.
Everywhere. Like, I'm not really the biggest New Japan guy, but once I found out that he was there, I was like, this is much watched TV.
I don't even know why that would even have been a comparison. Like, why would you put those two entities together?
I think because they're looking at it from the perspective of these are guys that have, again, evolved their careers and have existed in every pond and have brought something unique at differing points in wrestling history. But what people don't realize is Hogan wrestled in Japan. You know, Hogan wrestled in Japan.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And they made him fucking wrestle over there because
he had to wrestle.
He had to wrestle over there because they weren't going to take this bullshit.
Exactly. It wasn't nobody running into his leg.
Yeah, no. You know what I mean? He had to wrestle there.
And that's the kind of stuff that kills me when you look at it. I mean, Tommy Dreamer shared a clip, which was great. that he when Kamala passed away, and he goes, "Don't let the history books tell you. Don't let people's revisionist history tell you things."
Yeah.
And it was a video clip of Kamala slamming Andre the Giant.
Yeah.
And if you think about it, if you go by WWE history books, who slammed Andre the Giant first?
Hogan.
Right?
Yeah.
Hogan slammed the Giant, according to
history.
Vince McMahon's history books. Yeah. And this is what I mean. When you look at Vince McMahon's history books, he felt Jericho had to do to Vince McMahon what AJ Styles had to do to Vince McMahon.
Right.
He had to make him a believer.
Yeah.
And then Vince was like, fuck, this guy's got it.
Mm.
Let's let him go. Because remember, Vince wasn't sold on AJ when AJ came in.
Nope.
AJ made him a believer.
Yeah, he still didn't understand the premise of just him and as
like,
why
he's, like, I'll put you
he's
in a program
considered
somewhere.
Phenomenal. Yeah.
Right.
But he didn't know the true potential.
Yeah.
And that's what I mean. So in Hogan's case, Hogan had three moves of doom, rock and wrestling, and WO. Chris Jericho, not only was he big in Japan, big in WCW, big in WWE, big in AEW, but every time he did it, he became a completely different person.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Think about it. When he did Festival of Friendship with Kevin Owens,
iconic.
That was night and day
mm-hmm.
from the Painmaker
yeah.
in New Japan.
Yep.
That was night and the Painmaker night and day from the from Le Champion in AEW. You see what
save,
I mean?
Save us, Jericho. Like yep. they're all
different, and they all stand it out for being something different yep. for being unique. And
yeah, I think that's an unfair comparison.
I also think that, you know, Hogan's tried to touch things and tried to make gold and ended up being a stinker. I could say that Jericho like 90% has touched things and has turned to gold.
Well,
he
Hogan,
made a list over. Like the guy just,
Hogan's a cancer. That's the problem. And I hate to say it because so many people love Hulk Hogan. But Hulk Hogan, wherever he went, if he wasn't the star, he wasn't putting anybody over.
Nope. Yeah, he only cared about one thing, Hulk Hogan.
What
did Hogan do when he went to TNA? He made the whole storyline about his daughter and Bully Ray and him.
Yep.
And him. Ugh. Okay.
And so, that's what I mean. Jericho, and he talks about it now. He goes, my job is to go to AEW and work with these young guys, these young girls, help them get ready,
mm-hmm.
help them be the future. He goes, because my job is done. Jericho doesn't even have to wrestle.
Nope.
No.
Think about this. When he was in the booth those last week, a couple weeks back in AEW, I said, damn, Chris Jericho's a modern-day Bobby Heenan.
Yeah.
I'm like, he should just stay in the booth.
Yep.
And he's spoken about it.
He says when the time
yeah, when the time has come, he says, that's where I'm going to go.
Like,
I'm going to rock until I'm 75 years old.
Yeah, right.
Dude, imagine Jericho in a booth with Samoa Joe calling matches.
Unreal.
Yeah.
That's unreal. That could be done.
It'll be Jericho, Joe, and fucking Taz.
the triple threat. Yeah. It's just Jericho, and this is why when a lot of people give, you know, shit on Jericho for the feuds he's in with Orange Cassidy, whether it's them or Scorpio Sky, whatever it is, he's doing the job of getting these young kids
yeah.
ready.
Yeah.
And at the end of the day, he even said it in his podcast. He goes, I hated Orange Cassidy. I hated the idea of it. I hated the gimmick of it. I didn't think he could wrestle. Quite frankly, I didn't even want to look at him in the face in the locker room. He goes, and you know what I saw? How over he was. And I said, you know what? Let me make this kid a star. Let me try to help this kid grow in any way I can.
But that's why, because he saw something, and this goes back to what we have, especially over the years as fans. There are certain people you look at that you don't understand, and then you realize what it is. When I put my wife is a great example. When I put her on to Orange Cassidy, she said, this is the dumbest thing ever.
I still say it to this day.
But think about it. He comes out and he does it, and it's funny. And it works. And you know what the best part is? You're waiting in anticipation for him to flip the switch and start wrestling.
Right.
Like, when he starts wrestling with Chris Jericho, you're like, oh, shit, this guy can go.
Right, yeah.
But that's the best part of it. I like the Jekyll and Hyde aspect of his character.
Mm.
And the best part of it is he doesn't need to be a heel or a face.
He's just him.
He's just there.
He's just him.
Versus like Marco Stunt. You know, Marco Stunt needs to be comedy guy.
Yes. The Hornswoggle.
Yeah, pretty much.
He needs to be comedy guy. I could never take Marco Stunt seriously because he could never be booked believably.
True. Right.
100%.
It doesn't seem to me when I look at what Jericho has done, and you know, before we start wrapping it up. Jericho, although, like I said, Jericho has made it a purpose for him to keep pushing forward wrestling.
Yeah.
Keep making that a testament for anybody who wants to get back into wrestling, who's gone. It's like, yo, watch me. I'm doing this.
Yeah.
I'm still doing this. I'm here. Yeah. A lot of guys, people click on AEW like, oh, shit, Jericho's there. I didn't know that he was there. But let me ask you this before we wrap it up. If Jericho never signed with AEW, would AEW still be successful?
I agree. I agree. I think it would be. I don't think it would be on the. I don't think it would reach as many people because Jericho. Listen, if you meet someone on the street who stopped watching wrestling like in the early 2000s, and I tell you Chris Jericho's on TV this week, oh shit, Jericho! It attracts more people, but I do think the whole team of Cody and the Elite would have still made it somewhat successful. They would have found a replacement. Like they even said, if we didn't have Cody, no, if we didn't get Chris, we had a backup plan,
right,
which was CM Punk, but that wouldn't have happened.
All right.
Here's my thing. Chris Jericho is a guy that wherever he goes, he's going to do his best to put the company in a different standing.
Mm.
But there's so many other guys out there. Think about this. When TNA first started, who did they really have?
No one.
They had the biggest name they had was Jarrett.
Yeah.
Yep.
It was Jeff Jarrett.
So taking that aside, the biggest name in AEW without Jericho was Cody.
Mm-hmm.
And then the Young Bucks and Omega. You could have built off of that.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing was that the North American audience that wasn't savvy on the indies, the only guy they knew was Cody.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
Because the Young Bucks, yeah, you know the Young Bucks if you followed New Japan. You know the Young Bucks if you followed wrestling. But a casual watcher would be like, oh, it's Cody.
Right.
It's the same thing like what you just said. Oh, it's Chris Jericho. You have to find the guy that, regardless of the age group, will say, oh, it's blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
Like, oh, it's Goldberg.
Yeah.
And that's and you know, we always shit on why they bring these guys back like Goldberg and, you know, but the other day, it's just what he just said. It's for the people who stopped watching to come back and go, now I need to watch WrestleMania because my man Goldberg from the 90s is back.
Yeah, believe me, I have a whole bunch of those people that fucking...
Yep. Look at Brock Lesnar.
Yeah.
Brock Lesnar is the best example.
Yeah.
Brock Lesnar has, without a doubt, and I'll lob this to you guys to close it out, but think about it. Brock Lesnar has the best career period.
Yeah.
He's down.
He works 5 months... Maybe six. Let's go six on a good year.
Mm-hmm.
Every time he's booked, he's winning the belt.
Makes probably $8 million a year.
And doesn't show up on weekly television.
Nope, doesn't show up on weekly television. And best of all, whoever he puts over is on his terms.
Yeah, he calls his own shots.
He decides who he puts over.
Yeah, he calls his own shots.
Who else has that clout? If anybody should be compared to Hulk Hogan, it should be Brock Lesnar because Hulk Hogan would dictate the terms of how he put anybody over.
Yeah. Brock's like the maestro of professional wrestling. Like he literally he walks on his own tune of his drum. And
only
he,
guy that could throw the belt at Vince McMahon.
Yeah,
yeah.
To the point where Shane was gonna fuck him up. Like y'all don't disrespect my old man.
Yeah.
Think about that. Think about this.
Yeah.
And I'll just paint this picture. You walk back there, you throw the belt at Vince. Vince has his son and his son-in-law back there who you essentially work for.
Mm-hmm.
And what was done about it? Nothing.
Nothing.
It was recorded and that was it.
And that was it. Where was the disciplinary action?
None.
Where was the, yo, you can't do that. Where was the fine? Oh yeah, that's right. It didn't happen.
You best believe it. If Drew McIntyre did that shit,
everybody goes, "Oh, why?" Because he's mad Diesel. And he's like, "No, it's because he moves the needle."
Yeah,
he moves the needle, and that's all that matters. I don't think
anyone will ever have that power again.
And like you said, Hulk and Brock. Yeah, that's
Hulk and Brock are the only people that I can compare in that because there's nobody walking this planet now outside of Cena and the guys that have been made.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, there's nobody in this business that can walk into any promotion and say, I'm calling my shot.
Yeah.
Yep.
Doesn't matter. You get laughed out of New Japan if you walked in there and said, yo, this is what I... They'd be like, yeah, all right. Good luck with that.
Yeah. It's true.
And the thing with... And for example, to close it off, Brock... Everyone was hyped for that Brock and Ricochet match, right? We knew Brock was going to go over, but we expected at least a 10 to 15 minute kind of fight.
Yeah.
But guess what? But guess what? Like, I remember at the time everyone online was saying, "Yo, Ricochet's finally getting a chance. At least give me 10 minutes. Give me 5 minutes."
That's the answer to that.
Give me 5 minutes. And Brock walked in there and said, "Yeah, who's this guy? Yeah, I'm giving him 4 minutes." Yep. And Vince said,
"You put a cigarette out on that shit."
And Vince literally said, "Yeah, I know you gave Ray 22 minutes ago, but yeah, you could give Ricochet 5." And he did nothing about nothing. There's no repercussions. Nothing. Nope.
But
nothing.
Ray commands that respect,
right?
So Brock can't even pull that because
Ray earned it.
In that perspective, there's realness there.
Yeah.
And Brock is gonna be like, "Yo, I can't disrespect this dude.
Right.
This dude's a fucking legend in this business.
Absolutely. So
I can't talk to that dude that way."
It's just so crazy to hear what Rich said about how Brock could walk into a room and said, "What am I scheduled for tonight? Nah, that ain't happening. I'm doing a 5-minute segment, and Paul Heyman's talking the rest of the time, and I'm out." Yep. Vince goes, "Well, here we go. That's
doesn't
what's
have
happen.
To say a word,
that's,
and Paul
that's,
does
that's
everything.
What the champ said."
Yeah. And even if he's not the champ, this is what Brock do it.
Yep.
So, guys, when we come back, we're gonna have a wrestling rundown as well as Around the Square Circle and our conversation with That Punk
Isaac Rodriguez
stops in. So stick around, guys. We will return.
This is Jack Sabbath, and you're listening to Turnbuckle Tabloid.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the main event of Turnbuckle Tabloid. This is Wrestling Rundown.
Ladies and gentlemen,
come on, Matt, rap.
The news.
It's been a minute since you rap. Go.
Yo, I've been rocking with the news. Don't you know I'm part of the Thunderdome? Now it's time for me to get on top of the. Nachos, Doritos,
hey.
Cream cheese, and sour cream.
Hey.
Know about that.
Hey.
Mofongo.
Let me see you do a rhyme with Mori Soñando.
Poringo Fango.
Yeah, not happening.
Mori Soñando, I like Fandango.
Not happening. This week's wrestling news is
petty?
Yeah, pretty much. You always got one side of the fan base that's like, "Yeah, I love it." And then you got the other fan base that's like, "This shit sucks."
Yeah, it's a 50-50.
But more than likely, it's like, "This just sucks."
Basically, yeah.
So, as always, I am the Howard Stern of this segment with my Robin Ophelia quib is Olskey. So, Olskey with Artie Isaac, take it away.
All right.
Artie Isaac.
The first piece of news we have is that many people were speculating where Rey Mysterio would land, and it is confirmed that he has signed a 3-year extension with WWE.
Yeah.
It is unknown if he got a pay raise, but it is confirmed that he is with WWE for the next 3 years.
WWE loyal, son.
Red, do you think he re-signed because of Dominic, or you think that it was about the money?
Well, no.
People are saying that he might have missed the ball here. Maybe he could have went to New Japan for a little bit, face Amazing Red and Will Ospreay.
He wants to be with Son Holmes.
Listen, Red is older than fucking Ray is older than me.
is Red older than you too?
No, he's like he's somebody young. Is behind me. Yeah. But Ray is older than me. What the fuck are you gonna do? WWE is actually throwing him brick, and then plus, looking out for his son.
His son.
Yeah,
they had the.
It's a win-win, right?
Yeah.
But if he did not get signed, to WWE, where would you have liked him to go?
Home.
Wow. Okay.
I mean, honestly,
I'm happy to see Ray stay.
I'm not
3 years.
One of those that wants this. These dream match kind of shit going on by at this time. It's like I don't care.
I would have
Ray versus Will Ospreay.
I would have loved that though.
Okay, Ray versus Zack Sabre Jr. Okay,
would have loved that.
Apparently, he didn't want to see it. So
who, Ray?
Yeah. So all right, whatever.
Ray.
I'm happy to hear it though.
I was gonna say
you know,
Ray.
So congratulations to Ray.
Nobody cares.
Wow.
I've been in the danger zone.
Next up.
Next we have WWE news here, as it seems like there might be a new head of creative on Monday Night Raw coming soon, as it seems like
Isaac Rodriguez.
No, no. It seems like WWE is
Isaac Rojas.
What? Who said that?
Isaac Rodelia.
Throwback.
It seems like WWE is planning to replace
Isaac Kneecap.
Yes, the bronze kneecap.
Jesus Christ.
You remember that shit?
The bronze kneecap. I'm weak. That's a throwback. It seems like WWE is planning to replace Bruce Pritchard with the one and only, the man of Raw Underground himself, Shane McMahon. Woo! As Alex McCarthy is reporting that Vince McMahon may want his son to lead the Raw creative team. Why? The news sources have shown that Bruce Pritchard is, quote-unquote, exhausted from running Raw and SmackDown by himself. And it seems like he asked Vince to lessen the load. So, will we be seeing Shane McMahon?
Lessen the load.
Literally. Do you think it's needed? I think so. Do you think that Shane McMahon would be the good fit to be the lead of Raw Creative? What has he shown you in Raw Underground and other aspects of him being creative?
I guarantee if Shane McMahon takes over Raw, it's going to go to the highest levels of shit.
Wow, really?
Deadass?
You don't have faith in Shane, though.
Deadass?
Nope, not with the talent that's there.
Deadass?
Why? Does it mix?
Deadass.
Oh, fuck. He means it. Yeah.
Yeah, no, I don't feel as though that he's, with that talent that he has there, it doesn't work for him.
He's serious.
I don't think so.
I think he's trying to understand what the new talent.
You had a talent there. You had a Paul Heyman. That guy was.
I know.
You had a talent that could make it over.
Did he leave?
No, they demoted him.
They demoted him.
Why?
I don't think we ever found that out. But this is my motto with wrestling nowadays. If it happens, let's give him a chance. Because okay. I'm gonna be honest with you, we've been shitting on. We were scared about the Bruce Pritchard era, and can we be honest that Raw's been actually good.
Yeah, but he's so tired.
I feel like people complain.
Yeah, but Raw's been so good though.
But here's the
segment is important.
Yeah, but you say the Bruce Pritchard era, but you know what's crazy is that he's supposed to be running two shows, but apparently. Daniel Bryan's supposed to be booking the other show.
Daniel has a lot of say.
Quietly.
Daniel has a lot of say in terms of what talent to get over on SmackDown, but I do think that Raw's been a great product, and if it is under Bruce Pritchard, you can't really shit on it right now.
You notice why, like, how every company is getting, like, the wrestler or someone from the end, like, as that position? Have you noticed that? Like,
yeah, which is smart.
Marty Scurll.
You're supposed to do that.
Yeah,
when he was in TNA, stuff like that.
You hire internally.
You want to go from, like, experience, but also you want to be as in touch with who you're fucking with as possible.
The legit bookers and businesses like that should be former wrestlers because they know what it is to do.
Yeah.
But we'll see what happens. Whatever, Cool.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. And I'm all out of bubblegum.
It has been reported that after SummerSlam, Renee Young is officially leaving WWE.
My bitch! No, I'm kidding.
Go figure. You're the husband over at AEW is a champion, and you want to go. I get it, but she has announced that she'll be leaving after SummerSlam, and her future is unknown. And just after that grand old news, we find out that WWE is bringing back Talking Smack,
woo!
Renee Young show, basically. Red, where do you think what do you think of Renee Young's departure? Do you think it's because of a change in ideas? Do you think it's because she wants to go with her husband? What do you think the future holds for Renee Young?
Good looker, Basu.
And what do you think about
it's good for her.
What do you think about the Talking Smack announcement? Because that's really petty shit.
Oh, that's petty shit out the ass. It's good for her though because she's been in for 2012. They tried to expel her to do things that she's really not used to doing, which is the commentary shit or whatever. But everything else has been gold. But yet. You leave her out in the wind when it comes to doing her strength. So what do you expect her to do? It's like, what is my purpose here? She's honestly saying, what is my purpose here?
She really hasn't done much. I mean, now that show, WWE Backstage, has been chopped off, what else is she going to do?
Yeah, it's been done. So everybody's saying, my gosh, she's going to be great in All Elite. It's like, no, Fox and ESPN want her.
She'll be on Around the Horn, like, tomorrow.
Yeah, she's legit. Like, before people even know, she loved wrestling,
yes,
but her first thing was sports.
She's a big baseball girl.
Yeah.
Even Mick Foley said, I would not be surprised if I don't see her being the host of NBA on TNT, then with the World Series. Like, she is, like, very talented.
Yeah, she's legit. She's good with that. It doesn't have to be, oh, my God, I'm going to be with my husband. Shut the fuck up. If she does go to AEW, that's a big step down for her.
Yeah, I honestly, agreed. I don't think they need her. What's the point?
She's that good.
They have Dasha, whatever her fucking name is. Why do they need her?
Dasha pain in the ass. That would be a major step down. She's good to go to a big market. And who knows? Maybe she's stepping down because she's doing her cookbook and wants to get pregnant. Who the fuck knows?
Just when they think they got the answers, I change the questions.
Why everyone want to get pregnant, man?
That's what
quarantine,
I'm looking for.
Man.
Some Chris the King girls again, like, quarantine. Fucking all the girls, up.
Yo, all the girls are going to high school to get pregnant.
Anyway. Up next. Yeah. This week we found out that Sonya Deville was a victim in an attempt to kidnap and possibly hurt Sonya Deville.
Scary shit, man.
When Sonya Deville came face to face with a strange man on her back porch, she screamed to him, "What are you doing here? What do you want?" He then began to walk toward her. "That is when I realized this person was not here to rob me. He was there to hurt me." This is what Deville is saying. This is a quote from Deville. 24-year-old Philip A. Thomas II has been arrested for
what a name.
For an attempt to kidnap / hurt Sonya Deville. And
fuck that guy.
He was holding a knife and pepper spray when he came face to face with Sonya.
I bet he was shorter than Sonya.
He has three names, which means that's serial killer name. Yeah. John Wayne Gacy. Facts. Philip Seymour Hoffman. No,
Like we saw on SmackDown, they changed the gimmick to now loser leaves WWE match. As we see now, Sonya Deville will have to be leaving for some legal reasons to go take care of this whole situation. But yeah. Red, does this alarm the fans to say, stay being a fan? Like, there has to be some sort of line here.
Yo, the crazy thing about this is that it's not a big. She's a name in WWE, but she's not the big name like a
Becky Lynch or
Becky
Sasha
Lynch
Banks
or Sasha or some shit. She's Sonya Deville.
And plus, you choose the girl who had MMA background to go stalk. Get your ass like, what a stupid idea.
He's.
I'm not saying it's a good idea. Regardless, I'm just saying like.
If it had been like Aaliyah, it'd have been like, dude, you're weird.
What's the end goal? That's what I want. What's the end goal?
He wanted to kidnap her and take her to wherever the
ransom?
Fuck. I don't think it was ransom.
Bro, he brought a knife and shit. I'm pretty sure he wanted to kidnap her and hurt her.
What a fucking bum.
Also, reports were found out that, he got arrested for aggravated stalking, armed burglary of a dwelling, attempted armed kidnapping, and criminal mischief. Deville was also awarded a temporary injunction against him for stalking her. By the way, Mandy Rose was also on the scene, so that's why they're also...
Is that verified?
Yes.
Is that verified?
Yeah, she said it. Okay. Mandy Rose was with me.
All those put together equals a guy that has no motive in life.
And he has nothing else better to do but stalk fucking WWE wrestlers. Like.
Lowest of low.
Yeah, exactly.
But what is this a wake-up call to some people to go like, yeah, stick to being a fan?
No, the idea is make sure that you fucking watch your social media and see the creeps. So you can make a report about it. That's all it is.
Watch what you post.
I can't wait till I get a stalker.
Watch what you post, but also like just fucking keep your space.
I want
fans.
A hot female stalker. I want somebody.
No, you don't.
40 double D's and a 38 ass to stalk me. You know?
Damn.
Dude, this is crazy. You can't do this.
Where's Olski for the pop?
Wow.
Lightning round. I'm going to say it. You give me a quick response as quick as possible before we go to the main event story of the week. First news, lightning round. Here we go. Daniel Cormier is officially retired from the UFC. Wow. Will we see him in WWE?
Yes, but as a commentator, TV analyst.
Man, many people this week on Raw were upset about Shawn Michaels' terrible sell of the punt kick, saying that he disrespected the business. What are your thoughts on that?
I didn't know. I don't know what the fuck they were talking about.
I'll tell you right now. He did the punt kick.
Oh, I saw it.
And he got up.
I saw it.
Rather quickly.
I saw it, but I didn't see it was a no-sell.
I personally think it was a no-sell.
He was scared.
I think it was a weird sell. It was weird.
Yeah,
he was
a scared I would take old it Christian. As a no-sell. I'll take it as a weird sell. I would take it as a no-sell.
Little Christian.
Jesus put him to his feet.
Yeah, Jesus took that fucking wheel.
Jesus take the feet.
The Michaels.
Oh my God.
Jesus take the feet.
I hear you.
Eric Bischoff is rumored to be signing with AEW permanently. Do you think this is a good thing for Eric Bischoff? You think he should just stay home?
Can't call it. Depends on what the fuck his role is.
You don't need him.
Goldberg said that he has been called by AEW to do the streak again, but says that he is under contract with WWE for 2 more years, and he is doing just fine at WrestleMania.
If anybody cares about this, it's pointless. It makes no sense. It's stupid.
It's dick.
Listen, he even said, he goes, someone had to tell Tony Khan, it's like, that ain't, use your money towards young stars, not old fucking
news. Yeah, if anybody cares about this, it's stupid.
Rumors are running rampant that there will be a Raw Underground Championship debuting soon. Do you think that's where Raw Underground needs to be better?
Yes.
Yes.
What's your idea for the Raw Underground title? Do you think they should do rounds like UFC? Do you think they should do normal by knockout?
They should go to an office.
Do you think it should
next
be
week.
Like? Do you think it should be different from other fights? What do you think they should incorporate to make the title more legit?
Should be 1 minute rounds. They could use any weapon that they want to use. Beat the shit. Make it like a hardcore title, and then your winner's there.
It's a good excuse for a hardcore title.
Exactly.
Final lightning round topic here. Lars Sullivan has been posting workout videos saying that he will be coming back
to gay porn.
Wow. Does the WWE need a Lars Sullivan?
No.
And should they bring him back?
No.
Is it because of the gay porn?
Love no. the gays. Love the
what
gays.
Is it? What is it?
No, just it's because his fucking gimmick is horrible.
Love the gays. Hate the Sullivan.
Yeah, no, love the gays. Hate Lars Sullivan. But
give him a better gimmick. But let him be not the shit that he has now.
And finally, sorry, EC3 has been leaked to debut at Ring of Honor. Which, yes, it's
what
true.
What the fuck?
EC3,
that's so random.
So it's basically confirmed that EC3 is having the same contract that Cody Rhodes had, where he go where the
not
fuck
bad.
He wants.
Not bad, but hella random.
What do you think about EC3's idea to control his narrative by going to different companies?
It's
Do you think it's a good idea?
It's awesome.
Can good he bring luck. Ring of Honor back to?
Nothing can.
Nothing. I think Ring of Honor is dead.
They're
to be done. Honest,
they're good. As long as they're in Sinclair, it's over.
Speaking of Ring of Honor, unfortunately, we had a passing this week in the wrestling world. John Xavier.
Yeah.
Ring of Honor OG passed away this past week. Red and Isaac, I know you both know John Xavier. I honestly didn't have the honor to watch him wrestle, but any memories from the man? Because he was close to a lot of people's hearts around our neighborhood.
Xavier was actually, matter of fact, we met him. You probably don't remember. We met him at Hammerstein's 25th anniversary show.
Really?
Yeah, he was by us, and I spoke to him for a little bit, and then I spoke to him in the back. Cool dude. He was intense, though. He was kind of one of those intense kind of dude. I don't know what occurred and why he passed away, which is bothering me. Because
I heard a few things, but
yeah,
I'm gonna say
I heard some things. But he was a talented dude. He should have been bigger than he was. I would have thought that he would probably have been, if not bigger, but on equal level with Christopher Daniels.
Right.
He had that talent. The second Ring of Honor champion.
Yeah.
And New York bred, New York guy. And it's unfortunate. Young dude. He's younger than me. It's crazy.
Dude, you wait, real quick. You remember that ICW One Night Stand shit?
Yeah.
I think I commentated his last match.
Wow.
Might have been. Yeah.
Because that was his last match, remember, at ICW?
Yeah.
This year.
It was like 15. Like 15. It was
No. His last match was this year. He had one match.
When was it?
February.
Yeah.
And then they wanted him for the Pure Championship ROH thing. And
when is it happening?
I think it's this upcoming week or so. They're doing a Pure Championship, which I like the I like the
rest in peace,
for that.
Rest in peace.
Yeah, but rest in peace for Xavier.
Number nice vibes, bro.
Yeah,
he was like the locker room's uncles, and he trained the House of Glory students. When
cool
Red,
dude, man.
When Red wasn't there, he was their guy.
And I
so
remember
I
him.
I feel for everybody.
I remember from back in the days when he would do like the block party ring, like the ring, the wrestling shows and shit like that. Cool dude, man.
OG.
I didn't know him personally, but he was a cool dude.
The cream of the crop. Nobody does it better.
Not the one I want to do.
Not the right sound.
And finally, the last piece of news we have this week is that after being off TV for 2 months, Velveteen Dream returned to NXT 2 weeks ago to compete in a triple threat match for an opportunity in the North American Championship ladder match at NXT TakeOver. And the fans went mild. Many people have been questioning Dream's return and want WWE to issue a statement on the matter.
Big yikes.
Quick recap, Velveteen Dream has been accused of many situations where he texted underage women, underage men, sending nudes, asking for nudes, saying, what school do you go to?
What?
Oh, yes, that was a thing.
Michael Jackson shit going on here.
But Triple H finally revealed on Monday that Dream is quote-unquote innocent, and the only reason why he was off TV was because of the car accident he suffered back in June.
My ass.
As we noted earlier, many NXT wrestlers are not happy with Dream's return despite the strong allegations against him. Even Raw superstar Nia Jax went on social media and posted cryptic messages for him on Instagram after he was labeled innocent by Triple H. Soon after the news broke, she posted it on her story saying, zero fucks given, hashtag save the children.
Wow.
And on the post of WWE saying Velveteen Dream is back, she flooded the comments with clown emojis.
Oh.
Calling him a clown.
Ooh.
Saying, hashtag save the children, hashtag exposed. People on social media have Isaac even told me, hashtag fire Velveteen Dream was trending number two on Wednesday night.
Yeah.
And a lot of people are saying that without clarification or without proof, they shouldn't put this guy on TV. Before you respond, I want to also point this fact out. Many of the accusers have gone on social media this past week and said that WWE, number one, never contacted them.
Wow.
Number two, screen recorded more DMs of them having a conversation, also posting voice messages of Velveteen Dream asking how old they are and you look cute. And basically saying that they're not getting the justice they deserve and that WWE never called them, even though Triple H said that they looked it up into the matter. Red, I can already see your face on this.
Not a good look, man.
Isaac, I want to start off with you on this one because this is like the topic of the week. Isaac, what are your thoughts on the whole Velveteen Dream situation?
Not a good fucking look at all. Like, you got this fucking perv out here roaming around with his fucking flopping hair and shit like he owns this shit. Like, come on, just talk to Triple H, see what's up. Like, that shit is just bugging. They really have to look into that more. Like, it sounds like they did not give a fuck.
Well, Triple H said that he looked into it, but he didn't look into all of it. So he said if it arises again,
he'll
look into
it. So he's like, fuck it, let's put him on national television. Like, it's not a good move at all, dude. I would never accept that. That's like fucking, that's crazy.
Red?
Especially listen to the fans. Like, if they cared, they wouldn't do shit.
Oh, fans are furious right now.
Dude, if they cared about their fan base, if they cared about their fan base, we're not seeing them next week.
Dude, the Twitter on Wednesday was flooded with, yo, the fact that I have a pedophile on my TV right now is bananas. Red, I know you have a thought process on this, but go ahead.
I got something to say after, but yeah.
Go ahead.
Why would WWE waste their fucking energy to keep this guy on the roster? Why?
I don't even know.
He's not.
It's gone. The magic's gone.
No. But that's what I say. Magic's gone.
Yeah. His gimmick sucks now, to be honest.
He's done.
He's not a Roman. He's not done. A Rollins. He's not a Finn Balor. He's not on that caliber. He's not a fucking
Bray
Wyatt.
He was the top shit, man. That's what the crazy part. He was on a roll.
Top shit of what?
He was on a roll. He had some fire at the previous year, but he just fucked it up
for
himself.
He had a roll for like a year ago, and then he fizzed out, and then what?
Yeah, he fizzed out, for sure.
He fizzed out, and then what?
His face turned turn this year.
I would understand if the WWE was protecting guys of the caliber, like I said, the moneymakers, the Bray Wyatts, the fucking Finns, the Rollins, those kind of guys, the Drew McIntyre. But you're protecting him? He could fucking leave and get dumped tomorrow, and nobody would give a fuck. Like, it doesn't make any sense. So why protect them? So for me, I'm saying apparently WWE, who is basically trying to rebuke or fix what the fuck they did years ago with the Enzo Amore case and Richard Swann cases, where they dumped them without doing an investigation.
Bullshit.
That fucked me up because I liked Enzo
No, real talk, because like, I talked to Rich Swann. No, fuck WWE, honestly, because they completely took advantage and wanted to drop talent. Fuck WWE. And I don't even care. I don't want to work there anymore. I've gotten the opportunity. Fuck WWE, honestly. From the bottom
and then
heart.
Think about it
they
like this.
They are racist fucking Trump supporters.
Yeah, but think about
it
like this.
I don't want to sound like a fucking guy from Facebook, but honestly, fuck that.
But think about it like this. So why protect him? He ain't worth shit. You could get rid of fucking Patrick Clark. Velveteen
favoritism.
Green.
Favoritism.
Favoritism to what?
They like their boy.
But you could get rid of him and get someone who could fill in that slot.
I don't get it.
You
don't get it either.
Rid of
it's
him
fucking, it's retarded. They act
it
retarded.
It doesn't make any sense.
They move retardedly, honestly. It's
but
fucking
it's stupid.
Weird.
So to me,
yeah.
Unless they found something that was criminal or legit, what do you...
You get racist vibes, honestly, from there. I heard so many stories. I don't even
of course it's racist
just,
vibes.
Honestly, like, this shit is just mad stupid.
But you also got to
it's all favoritism, bro.
Yeah, but the favoritism to what? He's an accused... supposedly pedophile.
It's Triple H's boy.
You don't, but so what? That makes no difference. If Matt was accused of being a pedophile, I'd be like, you can't be the show anymore. That's it.
That's his boy. I don't know. It makes no
sense.
But it's
real.
It is real, yeah.
And the only way I would say is that unless I see proof that he did it, I'm not letting him go to Turnbuckle Tabloid. So apparently WWE didn't see any proof.
It sounds like it. The people came out.
It sounds like it. You know what's the problem is that you know how many people have been accused of wrongdoing and they found out they were innocent.
Yeah, later on.
And
yeah, later
still
on.
Find
it
out.
Fucks them up.
And they still yeah. have that hanging over their head.
You know,
here's my thing and what I've been saying for the longest for when this instance came up. Listen, first of all, my whole thing is apparently he was soliciting these individuals under his legitimate WWE profile.
Idiot. Like, come on, man.
Who does that?
It's fucking stupid.
Who does? Show me that you did it under his personal page, and I'll be like, "Yeah, that's creepy."
That's mad creepy.
But under his official WWE page, that's suspect. Who's dumb enough to do that?
In the accuser's defense, he doesn't have a personal page. That is his That is his only page.
Who?
Velveteen Dreams.
But the accuser says that?
No, I know it. Like, I looked it up. He doesn't have a Patrick Clark personal or nothing. No.
Why? Because it's probably private and you can't find it?
No. No one there's no Patrick Clark Instagram.
Okay, so that's actually makes it even more legit to say that maybe that's his fucking professional page and he doesn't do fucking social media. That's one. This is what I'm saying. There's so much logistics to it. It's
weird.
Yeah,
it is weird.
It's weird. And then you're talking about voice message. Nigga, I could put, excuse me.
Whoops.
But,
fuck it.
Nigga, I could put your face on fucking Edge and then it looks like you was in WrestleMania. With this fucking refacing shit. You think fucking technology is not that good?
He's stupid.
Am I wrong, though?
No. Nah. Triple H said he was innocent, man. I mean,
but am I wrong, though?
No.
Olskey was fucking, what's his name? Post Malone during fucking Jimmy Fallon's show.
That reface shit. Is that what
you, right?
Yo, we were using that shit for
am
hours.
Am I lying, though?
No.
You could be anybody now.
Yeah.
Unless it's legitimate shit, like, I'm dead ass, though. I saw, what's it? I saw Rondo fucking beat Brock Lesnar. What the fuck?
Godzilla trap.
Whole Milk Mike was, Dr. Evil or Fat Bastard.
Exactly. So, I mean, and Mark was who?
Mark was, The Rock.
But, The Rock. I mean,
Agent
come
two.
On. Look at the, number come two. On. Let's be for real. Unless you do it, extensive fucking research and fucking investigation. Why him? That's what I'm saying. Why him?
Out of all people, too, to keep.
Out of all him. Out of all people, why
fucking,
him?
It's weird. There's something missing from the story. Obviously.
Listen, and my whole shit is, until it's inconclusive and then you find out that it was him, then I could be like, yo, fuck him. Get him the fuck out of here. Yeah, fuck him. But apparently they didn't find
it. Innocent until proven guilty.
Yeah, so, I mean, come on.
And his name is John C.
Lastly, for all my end, Matt Jackson calls Orton boring. Apparently, after Randy Orton shoots his shot and fucking says that Matt Jackson and his fucking wrestling promotion is fucking ridiculous.
Wow.
Matt Jackson's return is Randy Orton is boring.
Ooh,
yikes!
Guys, your
fire.
Thoughts?
That's fucking fire getting thrown into the pit. He wants to start some shit.
It's entertaining. Like
it's working.
Yeah, it's working 100%. Randy is known to being a troll,
and so is Matt.
After they dropped a comment on the AEW spot, it was bound for greatness for social media. It was bound for entertaining greatness, and that's what we got. I mean, I love the jabs between the two. It's entertaining. I'm all for it.
You got a TikTok star.
At the end of the day, it's all for fun. Yeah. And if there's real menace, even better.
Ring of Honor has their Pure Championship tournament happening soon. I think it's next week. And also their tapings are happening this past week and should be up probably by next week. But the Pure Championship tournament, I like. I like the execution of it. I like how it is. You shake your hands. Yeah. You have a 10-minute, 15-minute first round. And a winner moves on. You make sure that you do the handshake before and after. Anybody who doesn't honor the rules They're kicked out of the tournament.
Very professional.
Like Tony Deppin's in there. Last round is a 60-minute match. It's a
pretty cool concept. Bring him out trying.
Yeah, I think they've done it before. I like this. I think it's actually really cool.
I'm all for it, man. Good, listen, we know a few talent in that tournament, so
it's a good comeback for Ring of Honor. I think that's something that a lot of
people... ROH, you better not fuck it up, man.
ROH, we fuck with this rap shit.
Yeah.
And lastly, there's a
what?
There's talk of a Raw Underground belt, and I think we talked about that. It lightly. And
yikes.
As one of those things I have to say is that I love belts. Bring more belts. I don't care.
I'm a belt guy.
Bring me belts.
I love belts.
I think instead of having a belt, they should have like...
Bring a white strap.
Yeah, bring me belts.
Bring me a white strap.
They wanted to look like... Supposedly, they wanted to look like the former hardcore belt. But me, I'm like, belts. Bring more belts.
Been there, done that.
I love it.
The championship be like the kingpin and get hookers and fucking be shit
new.
Like that.
Just be
Matt
new.
Matt just wants to see half-naked women on TV. That's what he's talking about.
I want USA Network to get dirty.
Of course.
But other than that, I guess that wraps up Wrestling Rundown.
Yeah, I'm tapping out, man.
So, guys, when we come back, we have our conversation for Around the Square Circle, and I'll talk with Mr. Isaac Rodriguez, the man, the myth, the legend that apparently is... I don't know, may or may not be tied to a wrestling promotion. Who the fuck knows? So, guys, don't go anywhere. Stick around. We'll return. Check it out for a second. What?
You're listening to a podcast where the host may or may not have masturbated to Nyla Rose. You're listening to Turnbuckle Tabloid.
Is FTR's new manager.
Is he really?
Yes, look, he has the FTR jacket on and everything. He's a new coach.
Oh my god. Is this where we're going to now?
Yes, I guess
it's inevitable, ladies and gentlemen. It's inevitable.
Well, the Four Horsemen is coming
exactly
soon.
I don't know what to say about that.
Everyone has a coach.
I guess. Everybody has a coach.
Around the Square Circle, ladies and gentlemen, the time of the episode where we go over everything we watched, listened to, beat our meats to. What? No. To professional.
No, you were
wrestling.
Right. We beat our meats to it. You were right. Yeah, you're right.
Did you enjoy the week of wrestling? Well, part because AEW had to fuck around with the NBA playoffs. But
yeah, man. They just threw the whole shit on the loop, man. They just fucked this whole thing up. For
it's
real.
It's all good. It's all good. All
right. Whatever. We'll make the best of it, I guess.
Before we start anything, it is only fitting that we do.
We do.
Predictions, ladies and gentlemen.
SummerSlam predictions, ladies and gentlemen.
SummerSlam weekend is here, and we have NXT TakeOver tonight and SummerSlam tomorrow. So, let's go over NXT's card real quick, and let's go over some predictions, shall we?
Sure.
First, to start off, we have Legado del Fantasma versus Breezango versus Oney Lorcan and Danny Burch for the number one contender. To be number one contenders for the NXT Tag Team Championship. I have Oney Lorcan and Danny Burch taking this one.
I am going to take I'll go the opposite.
I also have a really I do think Legado del Fantasma I might win as well.
Yeah,
But I'm gonna go with Oney Lorcan and Burch. What you got?
I said I'll go the opposite way. Fantasma number did it.
Finn Balor versus Timothy Thatcher. I'm gonna go with Timothy Thatcher. He needs the win.
This is a good match. I think something screwy might happen, but yes, this is going to be where everybody starts bitching at, oh, Finn is now a jobber to everyone now, blah, 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 blah. So Thatcher takes the win.
Adam Cole versus Pat McAfee. I don't even think it's going to be Pat McAfee in this match.
Screwjob finish, most likely, and it's going to be McAfee or whoever is going to be in his place.
I have Pat McAfee wins by Undisputed Era helping him win.
Okay.
NXT Women's Championship matches. We have Io Shirai versus Dakota Kai.
Io wins.
Io does retain. Up next, we have the NXT North American Championship ladder matches. We have Bronson Reed versus Damian Priest versus Johnny Gargano versus Cameron Grimes versus the Velveteen Dream. This is a good one. Who you got?
I'm taking Damian Priest for the win.
I am going to go with Damian Priest as well.
Okay.
And finally, NXT Championships. We have Keith Lee versus Karrion Kross with the NXT title. Who you got?
It looks like there was already spoiler showing this off, and it looks like Karrion is going to take the W and the championship.
I have – this is live or pre-recorded?
What?
Tonight.
It's live.
Okay, so we don't know yet.
All right.
I'm going to go with Keith Lee retains by roll-up. Scares the fuck out of Karrion.
The craziest move in wrestling history, the roll-up. The roll-up.
So that was our NXT predictions. Now let's go to SummerSlam real quick. Are you excited for SummerSlam this year, regardless of what's going on with COVID? Well, now with the Thunderdome, there's hope to make it more fun, right?
Yeah, that and not for nothing, but the lineup is actually pretty good.
It is. Let's go over it. And want to know why it's good? Because they're building story.
Yeah.
Up first, we have the Street Profits versus Andrade and Angel Garza for the Raw Tag Team Championships. I think this is finally the time where we see Andrade and Angel take these belts. Angel and Andrade are new Raw Tag Team Champions.
I believe so, too. And then we find out that Angelo Dawkins was the one who spiked the drink.
And he gave it to Zelina Vega to put in or some shit like that.
Yep.
United States Championship, Apollo Crews versus MVP.
Apollo's retained because I really don't fucking understand why MVP should have this belt.
Yeah, I don't know. Well, it's the rematch. Yeah. Which I thought WWE made a rule, no more rematches.
I guess
they squashed that one. I'm going to go with Apollo Crews as well. Sonya Deville versus Mandy Rose, no DQ, loser leaves WWE match.
Mandy wins because Sonya got to leave.
Yep, Mandy wins. Sonya got to go take care of legal business. Matt Riddle versus King Corbin.
We're going to go...
Matt Riddle.
Matt Riddle, please.
Up next, we have Seth Rollins versus Dominic Mysterio in a street fight.
Seth wins, but Dominic actually looks good during the match.
I'm going to go with Rollins wins as well, but I will say that Ray's going to fuck up on accident and screw him. Bayley versus Asuka, SmackDown Women's Championship. People are assuming that we might see two belts Asuka here.
I am going to say Asuka loses this one.
Absolutely, I agree 100%. Asuka loses, Bayley retains. And up next, Sasha Banks versus Asuka. Asuka will win that one.
Asuka will win this one because Bayley does something to fuck it up.
Yes, it's going to be a flip-flop. It's going to be Bayley's going to fuck up the match, but then Sasha's going to help Bayley win.
Right.
So it's going to be flip-flop. Braun Strowman versus The Fiend for the Universal Championship in a no disqualification match.
The Fiend wins.
The Fiend is your new champion.
The Fiend is the new champion because Alexa Bliss helps out.
Alexa Bliss helps out and is now The Fiend's new companion. Scarlet Bordeaux to his Karrion Kross, might I say.
Scarlet Bordeaux.
And finally, we have Drew McIntyre versus Randy Orton for the WWE Championship, the main event, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, you all right?
I'm good. Who you got?
Randy
goes over here, right?
Randy definitely goes over because Rick screws him over.
Who, Drew?
Yes, Rick will come and screw Drew over.
I say Randy wins clean. I think it can be a great match. Those are the predictions, ladies and gentlemen. And now on to further stuff this week. Red.
You alright over there?
Yeah, I'm good. It's just fucking the dust. I guess like outside is getting to me. You have a shout-out to make, don't you, with this new book you're reading?
Yes, this week I've been reading Sean Oliver's Kayfabe. Sean Oliver, you guys may know from the You Shoot videos for Kayfabe commentaries, timelines, and all that stuff. And, man, this has been I needed to pull away from all the political stuff that I've been seeing and posting and shit. So I was like, fuck it. Let me get back to doing some research for the show. And this book has been an eye-opener. It's been funny. and you get the pretty much the insight of what it is to be a part of the business of working with wrestlers. And he pulls no punches here, sirs and ladies. Whoever's
I don't expect
listening.
Him to.
Yeah, it's a real good. I told
Olskey, I'll be buying it.
Yeah, he needs to get it and read this. This is actually listen to it because I'm listening to it.
I'm gonna listen to it on my walks.
I'm a lazy fuck. I like people reading to me. So that's actually that's a good read for anyone out there who's into wrestling and wants to know about other shit on
wow.
the periphery of it. So yeah.
Any podcast you listen to this?
Let me go through my list quick. I have okay, on Saturday Night Special from the past week, Jericho continues to ban Cornette from watching AEW.
Oh,
he
nice.
Said if he does watch it or tries to watch it, he's going to take "quote unquote" legal action if he does watch it. he says the biggest thing that he misses about working in WWE is working with Vince because he said Vince always challenged him and his creativity.
Okay.
So he says I never really had a problem with my creativity. 9 times out of 10, there was things that I would ask for and I got, but that one thing that I wanted and I couldn't get, I would fight for it. And, you know, many times Vince was right for me not to do it.
Yeah.
So he also talks about the NXT reject who spoiled the Bischoff appearance, which I pretty much figure is Tino Sabatelli. That's my thought. And then in Corny's drive-thru, he talks about the Meltzer talk. We talked about it this week on the cutting a promo. He agrees. He's like, hey, I don't understand where these comparisons come from. I guess this is what it is. And lastly, it's new belt possibly for Raw Underground. Maybe? Are we looking at a championship belt in Raw Underground?
Yeah, we talked about it yesterday.
Right? So yeah, that's what I was looking at. I was like, maybe that's something there. So other than that, everything's good. Oh, and shout out to my people on Quite Frankly, a Howard Stern podcast, because once again, they shouted me out this week. The lovely
awesome.
Samantha
the love.
Therese
the love.
Shouted me out this week. So thank you, my dear, for shouting me out. So other than that, we can go move forward to what happened during the week.
Sure. Real quick, do you want to know who the Rock just announced who's going to be in the Black Adam movie?
Sure.
Hawkman, Dr. Fate, Cyclone, and Atom Smasher.
That's actually a good lineup. Especially with Dr. Fate.
I'm hyped for that shit. I love Dr. Fate.
Dr. Fate is their version of
Dr. Strange.
Dr. Strange, so yep. That's going to be cool.
All right, let's go to Raw, ladies and gentlemen.
Yep.
Because the air ain't running, I'm sweating. So
let's breeze through this.
I'm literally sweating right now already. We find out in the beginning of Raw that Retribution attacks the production truck and interrupts Drew McIntyre's opening promo. McIntyre calling Orton a piece of shit and pure evil, but quickly gets interrupted by the Retribution destroying the truck. Another piece of action here. So far, real quick, Retribution. Thumbs up, thumbs down. What we got?
I'm still riding with it.
Do you know what I'm noticed? I noticed that they're listening to the fans. The fans want a more serious Retribution. That's what they got.
Yeah, I'm riding with them. I'm still with it.
After the commercial, McIntyre and Seth Rollins go back and forth arguing who should be the leader on Raw's side to face Retribution.
Mm-hmm.
Which teases a feud after this. After that, we have Apollo Crews defeating Shelton Benjamin via pinfall. Shelton Benjamin then defeats R-Truth via pinfall to win the 24-7.
Ah, the 24-7
championship. Angel Garza defeats Ivar via pinfall, which that started because Ivar was taking his girl from The Bachelor, which was on 2 weeks in a row, which why? Okay. Angel Garza defeats Ivar there. What do you think about the whole tag team division being singles matches kind of vibe here? Like,
well, they're trying to shake things up, and they don't want to throw everything in one basket, so I don't mind the single match kind of thing. But the dog stop barking, please! Shit.
Whew. Natalya defeats Mickie James via countout and possibly the most disappointing return to in Mickie James' eyes. She
was not
happy. Someone asked Mickie James on her return because, after the match, quickly Rollins runs out and they start that segment. Someone asked Mickie James her thoughts on the match and she said it was bullshit.
Wow.
Because it was a count out in her comeback. It wasn't even spotlighted.
Yeah.
It wasn't even very disappointing there. It doesn't even matter if she lost. It was a terrible match. Shayna Baszler and Asuka defeat Bayley and Sasha Banks, both agreeing that after they both win their belts from Bayley and Sasha, that they'll be facing each other. via submission here. We have Shayna Baszler locking Bayley in the Karafuda clutch for the tap out. Also, this week, Peyton Royce defeated Ruby Riott via pinfall. Yo, I swear to God, this noise thing is going to come in clutch because it is unreal.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
Another.
And God, I just wait for this summer to over. I know. I got to worry about it. I could keep the door closed.
Yep. Oh, my God. Another step back for the Riott squad as Ruby Riott takes the L here. Then we go into Raw Underground as Dolph Ziggler defeats Eric on Raw Underground. I thought that was absolutely... Oh, by the way, it wasn't Eric. It was a random guy. Okay, I don't know why my notes say that, but it was a random... Eric defeated a random guy before Ziggler graded. Fuck, See, the heat's getting to me. Eric defeated a random guy before Ziggler graded his performance a 4 out of 10. Eric then threw down a challenge to Ziggler, and the two went at it in an underground match. After some tight mat wrestling, Ziggler grabbed a rear naked choke and used a thumb in the eye to get the finish. After the match, angry Ivar knocks down Ziggler, which will cause them to fight next week. Rey and Dominic Mysterio gained a bit of revenge on Rollins and Murphy as they gave Rollins and Murphy a lashing of the kendo sticks. What do you thought about this segment?
I think the candlestick is like very much overly done now.
Well, that's clearly the theme.
I know
of,
it's
of
the theme.
Fucking,
yeah, I get
of
it.
The show, of,
I get
of
it.
The program.
Yeah, but still, it's like, all right.
Arturo Ruas and Riddick Moss battle in the best fight in Raw Underground history. That was an absolute banger.
Yeah, everybody seemed to love that shit. I was a fan of it.
That was what Raw Underground needs to be. It was aggressive. It was quick. It was throwing each other out of the ring. Those two deserve 5 stars for the week because they killed Raw Underground this week. Also, Bobby Lashley, MVP, and Shelton Benjamin defeated Apollo Crews, Ricochet, and Mustafa Ali in an elimination match. Way too long for me. Are we seeing a tease of Cedric Alexander possibly going with the MVP, as they did not pick him to be in the six man?
Interesting.
And MVP giving him a little pep talk. What do you think?
Interesting. I don't know if that's gonna. I don't know if I'm gonna be a fan of that though.
We'll have to find out.
Yeah.
Also, Cedric Alexander defeated Shelton Benjamin during that match to win the 24/7 championship. There was like 8 24/7 championship segments on the show.
Yeah, then too many fucking title changes.
Then Cedric Alexander defeated Akira Tozawa to retain the title, but then Shelton Benjamin defeated Alexander again via pinfall to win the belt back. On Raw Underground, Nia Jax and Shayna Baszler almost threw it down on Raw Underground, but Nia Jax just walks out and leaves. Montez Ford defeats Andrade via pinfall in a pretty good match. I actually enjoyed that more than I expected it to. And, look at my notes here. What am I missing? And then finally on Raw, we had Drew McIntyre coming out after Randy Orton punted Shawn Michaels.
Which people were not happy on him taking the punt.
Yeah, because he no-sold it, basically. He, like, crawled up to the corner and automatically... You're supposed to be knocked out cold, and he got up and was like, I'm fine, trying to get up. Like, that's not how a punt kick's supposed to be sold right now, Sean. I understand if you don't watch the product, but it's okay. it's all right. It happens. Drew McIntyre with the great sell, calling him a piece of shit, and the Raw fades to black.
You're a piece of shit, Randy.
Yeah, you're a, I hate you.
I hate you, Randy. You're a piece of shit.
I love all of it. Up next, we have no AEW this week because it is on Saturday, and I'll give you guys the breaking news. I'm not reviewing it, so we'll talk about it next week. I really don't care. On NXT this week, we had Johnny Gargano facing Ridge Holland. As it was a pretty good match until Ridge Holland spiked Gargano on the head, which everyone was worried and upset about. What do you think about Gargano and Ridge Holland? Do you think Ridge Holland's a future star?
No.
What do you think?
It looks good.
What do you think about the match? What do you think about the match?
It was okay. He's decent. He looks like he can go and hang on for about a good 10 minutes, maybe.
Wow.
There's still more to come for him.
Shotzi Blackheart and Rhea Ripley get revenge on the Robert Stone brand this week after defeating Mercedes Martinez and Aaliyah. While Shotzi pins Aaliyah, the real point of the note was the big time powerbomb Ripley delivered to Martinez on the floor, adding some heat to the eventual killer feud. What do you think about Rhea Ripley and Mercedes Martinez?
This is something I've been longing to see.
And I'm all for it. I love it. Absolutely love it. El Legado del Fantasma defeated the trio team of Breezango and Isaiah Swerve Scott this week. Santos Escobar pin Tyler Breeze after the referee deemed Tyler and not Isaiah the legal man when it looked like Swerve had the champ pinned. Simple build. It was a great match. It wasn't great. It was fun. And it's just building up for Swerve and Santos Escobar there. Nothing crazy to say. Quick thing there. Gargano won against Rich Holland. Just wanted to point that out if I didn't say it before. Dakota Kai and Io Shirai getting to some business, getting to some heat, some action before the pay-per-view this week. And Raquel Gonzalez comes back and powerbombs Io Shirai to shit. Will Raquel Gonzalez be an important factor in this match tonight?
Yes.
Will she cost Dakota Kai the belt?
Yes.
Will it be an accident?
No.
Whoa. She'll be pissed off and just walk away.
Yep.
Also, this week, we find out that Adam Cole and Pat McAfee go back-to-back. What do you think about the whole segment about Pat McAfee bringing his boys from the football team, from football?
Listen, it was a good lead-up to it. I tell you one thing, though. I don't know whether he built up good heat or go-away heat, because I know the fan base on social media hated him.
People are saying that Pat McAfee is very good at this wrestling thing. He's a natural heel who always had the gift of gab. But even with all of that, his promo against Adam Cole this week was very strong. That's what people are saying online.
Listen, all you got to do is come off as a pretentious prick who has a lot of money and people will hate you.
So. Exactly. That's exactly what he's doing. So Adam Cole and Pat McAfee exchange some words. It gets heated. And that's the buildup for tonight. Finally, Velveteen Dream defeats Finn Balor in the main event to earn a spot in the second chance ladder match. To be honest, I can't get into Velveteen Dream matches right now. The shadow of the allegations is tough to get past for me. I know that, like, we just had a cool conversation about it, but it's still weird for me. It really is. Bronson Reed was left standing after all the entire group were fighting. He held the gold at the end, which shows that he will not be winning. I think Damian Priest or Gargano will be picking up that win. And finally, no AEW this week. Did you watch Impact this week?
No.
Holy shit, it's hot.
No.
And no Impact?
No.
Did not watch it either, unfortunately. Sorry, I will not lie to you people. I'm not gonna fucking suck beef and tell you guys what I haven't watched. And finally, on to SmackDown, as we were in the Thunderdome.
Yay!
We registered and we got in, ladies and gentlemen. My laptop was here and I was in the Thunderdome. I'll be posting pictures in the Thunderdome on social media this week. It's going to be great. It's hilarious. It was the best time. What do you think? What are your quick thoughts on the debut of the Thunderdome?
I thought it looked really good. I you know, people are bashing it and saying some other shit, and I think they're really stupid for saying it. Got to give WWE some love for giving it a try. And
they're
like
trying.
I said, it looked good. It looked good. It looked like the intro.
It looked great. It was the screens look awesome. Some people fell asleep. There was a teddy bear. It was absolute madness.
I laugh because of that, because people think, oh, the show's boring. But you also got to understand, dude, some of these guys live across the world. That dude could have been from Britain or some shit like that.
Exactly.
So.
You don't know. They might be up at 4 in the morning watching this shit. You don't know. The show starts off with Vince McMahon in the ring announcing welcoming everyone to the Thunderdome. The Fiend makes his entrance. The lights go down, and it was cool to see. What do you think about the stage setup with the lights and the pyro?
It brought energy back. It brought some love, man.
Yes, it did. Absolutely. So the Fiend's about to get on Vince McMahon, but then Braun Strowman comes out. I don't know who the face is here. I don't know who the heel is here. That's the one negative thing I have to say about this whole feud. I don't know who to fucking cheer for. I really don't.
I remember people were speculating if there was a double turn, and I'm like, nah, not yet.
I think this is a heel versus heel match. Yeah. I swear to God, I really do. He gets in the ring, confronts Wyatt, and then everyone from Retribution surround the ring. The Fiend gives him a smile and leaves. Boom. Leaves Braun Strowman by himself, and Retribution beat up Braun Strowman as a whole, but then the rest of the SmackDown roster comes out to save him. Braun Strowman then punches Drew Gulak out and leaves us to break. What the hell is Braun Strowman doing? Is he a heel?
Like I said,
he punched Drew Gulak in the face. So I guess whatever it is.
Yeah.
Up next we had Big E versus Sheamus, which was actually a pretty good match. I really enjoyed Big E's work here. Big E wins by pinfall with a schoolboy pin. No one expects Big E to do a schoolboy.
The super roll up.
Baron Corbin attacks Matt Riddle at ringside. Riddle fights back, and E takes advantage of the chaos. Why were they ringside? Because the SmackDown roster was defending the ring from Retribution. Up next, we had Jeff Hardy saying somebody fell on his leg from behind and he needs a brace to make his title match against AJ Styles tonight. Great story there. Lucha House Party fight Nakamura and Cesaro for the SmackDown Tag Team titles. Of course, Cesaro and Nakamura retain. This is when I was in the Thunderdome. This was my segment. Like I said, it was an absolute ball. I wish I could tell you more about it, but we gotta go, and I'll tell you more about it on a different day. But it was a great fucking night. And then we're teasing a Kalisto heel turn here. He has the gloves. He has the facial hair. The dude's turning heel. Kalisto's gonna be on it by himself, which is
Kalisto Ultimo Dragon.
I'm okay with that. They start being pissed at each other. By the way, Cesaro did. Grandma Talik gave Cesaro an avalanche Frankensteiner. What a fucking man! What a move. Like I said, they retain, and Lucha House Party is not a full unit. Backstage, AJ Styles was being told by Abyss his prediction to win tonight. It was pretty cool to see Joseph Parks back there. Mandy Rose and Sonya Deville announced that it won't be a hair versus hair match. It'll be a no DQ. We had Naomi coming out to Sasha and Bayley with the Beat the Clock Challenge. Sasha Banks beat Naomi, and Naomi beat Bayley. Of course, you got to do the flip-flop. Because Naomi beat Bayley, Sasha Banks will go on second at SummerSlam.
Oh, okay.
Only fitting as the one match who loses will be last. And finally, Nikki Cross is wondering where Alexa Bliss is and why she seems off. Daniel Bryan cut a promo during AJ Styles' entrance. And we have Jeff Hardy winning the Intercontinental Championship. Red, what do you think about Jeff Hardy being the new champ? Too soon?
No. I think it was right time. Better to do it now than on a bigger platform. Great, especially for the new look for the Thunderdome.
Yeah.
That was actually a better look for him to do it there.
Great match. Just not a fan of that Jeff Hardy had to sell a whole leg injury. What was the point of him selling an injury if he's just going to win? Like, that makes AJ Styles look kind of weak, doesn't it?
Not really.
I beat you with a fucked up leg. Like,
Not really. It just means that AJ didn't do his schoolwork and he didn't really. And by the way, he was the one that kicked Jeff in the leg.
Yeah, I know. Up next, we had the Firefly Funhouse. Bray talks about Thunderdome and asks us to come closer so he could tell us something. He loves us. Wyatt gets a call on his hand and chats inaudibly for a moment. Blah blah blah. Braun Strowman and Bray Wyatt go into an absolute brawl and ends up with Bray Wyatt being so hurt he needs to be handed into the ambulance, and the Fiend comes out of the ambulance.
Oh.
In sheer theater. So that was SmackDown, ladies and gentlemen. That was the first night of Thunderdome. And that's all the week we got in wrestling so far, guys. I mean, we'll have the reviews for the pay-per-view weekend next week.
All right, guys. When we come back, we have a conversation with Isaac Rodriguez, formerly known as That Punk Isaac. He's coming in to sit down and talk to us about what happens and the behind-the-scenes of what goes on at VXS, Violence and Suffering. And also, he and our boy Olskey tell us their tales and follies of what occurred during No Justice, No Peace this past week. So, guys, don't go anywhere. Stick around. We'll return. Check you guys in a minute.
Yeah, what's going on? This is your boy, Mike Harvey, and we're listening to Turnbuckle Tabloid.
I'm a producer, baby.
Shut Money by this man right here, Isaac.
Isaac is in studio, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah. He wants to make it clear with everybody. He wants to make it real clear to everybody.
We gotta get real serious now.
We have to like tone it down. We don't want to make.
Let's
it sure.
tone it down. The mood down.
We gotta make it. We gotta make it sure that people know. Isaac's in the building to talk some.
What's up?
Some legitimate shit and some real shit. Some Thank down you. The line shit.
Thank you.
And even with that, I can't take him serious. Fuck him with this bullshit. Even with that, I can't take that. Yeah.
My man's family.
For sure.
Oh my family. God. First of all, before we.
It's been a while.
Yeah, man.
It's been a while.
It's been a while.
Since I am.
It's been a while.
You guys don't understand. When the mics are off, we do the most stupidest shit. Yeah, back and forth.
Okay, now
each
let's
other.
Talk serious. Yeah. Fuck that.
We go back and forth with the rules. When niggas here, when the mics are off, okay, listen, we got to be professional with this shit.
Yeah, we were mad serious.
The amount of time.
Professional with this shit. All
right, we got to be serious. It's been a while. People want to know.
It's funny because Olskey would tell me some shit here. He goes, yeah, such and such needs a shout out or something. I'm like, shout, lay it all out.
Copyright that motherfucker.
Everybody's like, I guess I have to be in a joke. I guess we have to be in it.
I treat it, yo, I remember, I missed this is the Three Amigos chat.
Oh,
I love this shit.
It's
I love
horrible.
It.
We have a group chat that is just exclusively for us.
What's the name of it again?
VXX.
We change it like every couple of weeks. We do.
Teddy Hart's Moonsaults.
King Rondo's Palace or some shit like
the
that.
The last one was VXS. It was like
VXX. Jesus
and
Christ.
And then you have to see the fucking profile pics that we put up.
Oh, my
it's
God.
The best.
It's great.
It's terrible.
Messenger's awesome.
We only know each other from it.
Yeah,
it's
horrible. It's the greatest thing. I look forward to waking up and seeing the chat that I've missed when I was asleep.
Sometimes it's people that we know. And some it might be you if you're listening to it.
It probably is. It probably has been once at a time. It's probably been you. So be pleased.
No, but I always have to say, and we always give the man shout outs and praise for what he does for us. If you guys don't know this young man, very gifted, very talented, not only in the field of conversation, because he always brings contests, right, Melvin?
Reber,
talk too much.
But he's also behind our graphics, everything that has to be. Very prominent in the social media world.
Yeah, you see,
he's our guy.
You see that microphone with the thunderbolts and the mic? Yeah, guess what? Guess what? I'll give you a hint. That was Isaac.
He stole that from YouTube. Anyway. But I have to,
Isaac has done our t-shirts. He's done our
but not
graphic
only that,
work.
He's fucking family, man.
Yeah.
And with family, we go to for nail and fight each other and all this shit. I fucking ribbed the shit out of him for fucking weeks. And it was, yo, even Olskey was coming back to me. He was going, dude, you gotta stop. He keeps hitting me up. He's upset. He's like, yo, you gotta stop. I'm like,
oh. I don't want ribbing no more. I missed the three.
Olskey was like, he was the most concerned.
I was upset because I
was like, there's a problem with the family. We need to fix this. Why don't you want to talk to him anymore? Because
I missed my triangle.
But did you see where I was coming from?
I'm sorry, say that again.
Did you see where I was coming from?
Yeah,
what I was saying?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Ballsack goes to a fucking other podcast and tells them that it was his first fucking interview. And I was like, oh, really? Yeah. Then we go on his
we copy and paste the episode on the chat.
But not only that, we go on the fucking interview he was on,
yeah.
Troll the shit.
Yeah.
And then they stop blocking, and then they block
I was
going to
say, is they blocking? Is that why?
Yeah.
I think so. Yeah.
Why else would it be? I mean, maybe because
they didn't know what a strain was.
But the
bro, in the comment section, I said, what's a strain? And she goes, what is that, a camera lens?
I'm not sure.
No, but the other thing was, this is not his. And then we send the links to where his.
Even hold up Mike, put in the comments, no, this is not.
But she still talks to him.
Yeah.
Fuck?
Listen.
Come on, guy.
We're not losing much. I'm good.
Oh, guy. But as well, I said, this is family. Until he burns me on the cross and fucking burns the bridge, he's family.
Until he burns the bridge.
I love this kid. Like I said, and when it comes to stuff like this, you don't really gravitate and are pulled into an individual that you feel as family until you know it's genuine. I'll do a quick synopsis. I met you guys at the same time.
Yeah.
Yep.
We met at the House of Glory show.
Yep.
Was that at last?
I don't remember.
I don't
what
know the name,
the,
but I remember.
I think so.
It might have been at last.
I think it was at last. I thought the main event.
I think it was Ray and Red. It might have been.
What was the joke? It was the Lucha Brothers joke. What was it? The Lucha
It was the one where Homeboy said that.
What was it?
Ray should have been part of the Lucha Bros.
I'm like, yeah, okay,
no,
yeah.
No, that's not when we met.
What was
yes, it?
Yes,
it was.
Rey Mysterio should join the Lucha.
No, that he made that comment in front of the Elks Lodge.
No, that was at Amazura. It was at Amazura.
It was at Amazura.
You know why?
I remember.
And I'm going to tell you why.
Because Ray was at the show.
And I'm going to tell you why. Because Josie's Boy and I. And Super Producer Selly never make it early to a venue. As you guys know, we're always late. Right. We're always coming. We're always at the back of the line.
And you guys were always like, come on.
We're like, now we good. That day, we were there early. And you guys were probably like three or four people ahead of us. Mm. And you guys were cutting ass and shit like that. It was you, Whole Milk, Matt.
Yeah, we're cutting everybody's ass.
You guys were cutting ass.
And we gathered together and started roasting everybody.
Josie Boy and I was in the back. Not in the back, but we were not too far from him. And we were sitting there like, Yo, these fucking guys are funny.
Mad chill.
We had our signs and shit.
Yeah, you guys didn't know about it. I popped. I was like, yo, Matt, look at the signs.
So I marked out. I was like, yo, we got to hang out with these guys.
So it was meant to happen.
So when Homeboy had said,
Homeboy walked up and he was like, yo, you know what should happen? Is that Rey Mysterio should join the Lucha Bros. And fucking Isaac was like, said no one.
I was like a dick, bro. I was a dick.
Wait, no, you're right, dude.
Lucha
Dragons.
Said no one ever. The Lucha Dragons.
Like, what the fuck?
And he had like ruthless, a cowboy hat and shit. I was like, dude, you are on planet Mars.
And we sold the fuck out of that shit during the show. It was awful. It was terrible.
It was hecklers joined together for the great cause of heckling.
But I'm talking about you guys. Out of all that, and honestly, it's been a fucking ridiculous ride after that shit, yo.
It's been history. It's been fucking hilarious, man. Absolutely.
I look at Isaac and I go, I can see this kid who barely had facial hair. Now he...
I didn't have eyebrows. I didn't have facial hair.
I remember I met Isaac in...
You guys met where?
We met in high school, man. Christ the King. I remember when I was cool with Isaac before that, but
we didn't even talk about wrestling too.
No, it was all before music. It was before we were cool with wrestling.
We fucked with Green Day, and then we were talking to like homeboys about starting a band and shit.
We were about to start a band.
Yeah,
we went to California.
Imagine if we did that,
Isaac.
Dude, we need to start a band.
Yo, you know, it was supposed to be me, Isaac, Fadesh, and Zachary, and my friend Zach, and my friend Andrew. But no, me and Isaac go to California, and we went on the Transformers ride together.
We were roasting everything we see.
It was hilarious, dude.
All the girls were ugly there. Anyway.
Did I ever tell you a story about how Isaac and Isaac?
Oh yeah, no.
You did, but you want to share it to the listeners?
Absolutely.
I hate you.
Absolutely. What are you talking about?
Yeah, this is a shoot, right? Yeah, you got it.
So. So we go. So it's me and my boy Juan in my room.
Of course, senior year, Juan.
And Isaac's with my friend, other friend Mike Marzano, and another kid named Ricky. So he has Chipotle for the first time ever.
Yes.
It had to be Chipotle.
How long? It was like 30 minutes after.
It was like 30 minutes after we got back to the room, and all of a sudden.
It was about 50 pounds years ago.
And before we head out to dinner, like he said, they said free time, so I take a nap, and my friend Juan is chilling.
Yo, he was sleeping.
So I was knocked out, so I wake up. I wake up before dinner, and I'm like, the fuck is that smell, son? And Juan points to the bathroom. And I'm like, nah, who's in our bathroom right now, son? And the only person I knew had the balls to use our bathroom was Isaac. Either Mike or Isaac.
That sounds like some Mike shit.
The balls to use the bathroom was Mike or Isaac. So I bodied that shit. I knock it. I'm like, who's this? He goes, it's Isaac. I'm like, bro, what are you doing? yo, that Chipotle fucked me up, bro. I'm like, what happened? He goes, yo, he's right there. I'm on the phone.
I was like, I'm in the bathroom.
He was like, yeah, someone else is using my bathroom, so I had to use yours. He goes, I actually clogged it. I'm like, bro, you just clogged my toilet, so I gotta take a piss. He goes, can you use the guest one?
I didn't clog it though. I was fucking. I was fucking around, bro.
Why didn't you pee in a tub? If you had to pee,
I don't pee in the tub, bro. You know my rule.
Come on, man.
When you shower?
No.
Are you? You don't pee in the shower?
No.
Oh my god.
He's lying.
I don't believe that.
I swear
that
I don't pee in the shower.
Everyone, every guy does.
He's so white. You jump out the tub and then pee in the toilet.
It just happens.
I don't pee in the tub.
Oh, Jesus.
I'm not staying my own pee.
Hold on, we got a call. Hold on.
I didn't even know the Skype was on.
How the fuck this happened? Turnbuckle Tabloid, who's this?
Marco.
Well, guess who's calling in?
Oh.
Your favorite. Caller of all time.
Oh, no.
No.
The one.
No.
The only.
No fucking way.
Gregor.
No!
For those of you who don't know, it is I.
No.
Gregory.
The fuck you,
the
been?
The great.
Fucking Gregor. How the fuck did you know we were going to be on? I didn't even know Skype was going to be on.
How'd he find out?
I don't know. Thanks for calling in, Gregor. What's up?
Yes, I know. It's been some time since I called in.
I know. Yeah, exactly.
You see, I've been busy.
What you been doing? What happened? What you been doing, Gregor?
I've gotten married.
Get the fuck out of here!
No way.
Get the fuck out of here.
I finally made it official with my mail order bride, Natasha. We're finally husband and wife.
Well, congratulations, Gregor. That's good for you, man. I hope that everything goes well with you, man. That's great.
Look at that.
I'm not happy for you.
I get married, and Olski, from what I'm hearing on the show, still can't get laid.
Oh, God.
Tisk.
He's a snort.
Tisk.
Wow. Oh, nah. He's snorting.
Still say you can't get no ass.
That's all right.
What's going on, Gregor?
Don't change your mind on that.
Seems like some things haven't changed.
Yeah, he's going in.
Hey, James.
Yeah, what's up?
Still knocking down the old libations.
Yeah, I have one in my hand right now.
You know, alcoholic beverages.
Yes, I'm doing it right now.
We're still drowning the liver.
Wow, he's calling you
alcoholic. Yo, he's snorting.
His liver needs a scuba tank and a snorkel.
Wow.
You fucking asshole. All right.
Wow.
Gregor, why are you calling? What's the problem? Yeah, why are you here?
What magic made you decide this day?
I see that punk Isaac is in the building.
Hey!
Hey, Isaac. How you doing?
The fuck you want, man?
He's a Gregor Mark. He's here for you, man.
I hear you're doing good things these days. Hear that you're possibly connected. Wink, wink.
What the fuck are you? You just say it. You know that, right? You just say whatever you want to say. You don't
shoot, partner. What
the fuck are you talking about, guy? Stop snorting.
If I were you, I would leave these losers behind and go to a real podcast that actually knows how to bring entertainment to the masses. Because these two jerks can't even get over
you kind of promo
in an audience in front of their family members.
What an ass!
What a dick!
Who watches their crap?
Why do I even pick up the fucking call from you, man? Could you let us know why you're here? What are we doing here, Gregor?
I hear you guys were promoting this wrestling event this past week called DXS.
Yeah, DXS.
I was able to catch it on Fight.
Oh, nice. Thank you.
From what I took from it,
what you thought?
VXS should stand for
what?
Very extreme suckage.
I don't know about that, Gregor.
That event was horrible.
That's a very bad word, Gregor. Come on.
What do you get when you put two horrible things together?
What's that, Gregor?
Let me guess.
Give up. Uh-huh. You get violence and suffering and Turnbuckle Tabloid.
Suck my dick, Gregor. Suck my dick.
That's horrible, Gregor.
Snort your way back to Jamaica.
The rope's broke. Just like Olski's heart when he found out it takes a long time to get laid.
Wow. He's coming for your neck, son.
Let me tell you something, bro. You're married to a fucking food group. Fuck you, bro.
Now, now, guys. Don't sound bitter. I'm not going to be on the phone for long. I have to have relations
like eating his
with my lovely Natasha.
Okay.
Is she real?
We're in Skyrim.
And Jay, you'll be happy to know that she is nice and young and spry.
Oh, good for you.
Unlike you.
Wow.
Who hasn't seen the word young since you were in kindergarten during the roaring 20s.
Oh, wow.
How dig
it took him a while.
He's
old.
He's calling you 95
Stop
years
snorting,
old,
bro. You're on a fucking show. Stop
All
snorting.
Right, guys. Oh, okay. Gotta go.
Breathe. Oh, gotta go.
Grego has to do adult things now.
All right, what the fuck you want?
By adult, I mean... I have to help Natasha with her ingrown toenails. It could get quite messy. And Mama needs someone to hold a foot while she pulls out the old tweezers and nail clippers. Natasha could get a bit feisty.
Jeez, I don't even know that.
Later, dweebs.
Get out. Stop snorting, bro. Where the fuck has that guy been?
I have no words.
I'm speechless. I'm fucking speechless.
I have no words.
Yo, every time he comes
macaroni
on...
Macaroni and cheese.
I don't know whether or not he comes on, whether it's good fucking audio or I really want to punch him in the fucking balls.
Kind of both. I think it's kind
of
both.
It was like a roller coaster of like volume. Like it was like he was far away and then when he was like roasting us,
he started losing stamina.
Oh, yeah. I think he does that on purpose.
Yeah. Oh, I don't think he can breathe right. So
wow. The snorting on that guy.
Motherfucker. But he does bring up some notes. He says that
Isaac, connections.
You are connected.
The mafia or some shit?
I don't know.
Are you connected to the mafia? What are you doing?
Come on, nah.
And he brought up the VXS kind of thing. Wink, wink, eye. No, but honestly, we've known for a long time, and we've always kept that on the wraps. That finally, that you've actually pursued what it is that you've been wanting to do for years, man. It's just be a backer and part of a wrestling promotion. So. Just give a brief synopsis of what we're promotion and what we've been doing. Because unless people don't know,
it's a big deal.
VXS is on the way, man.
It's crazy because I actually didn't even like going into like being the booker. Like it's like I was never like searching for an opportunity, but it was like just given. You know, it was just like it was something that legit. Like I didn't. It was the last thing in my mind. It was like last December. When was for the children's last December?
It was around that time. Yeah.
And like, I see a lot of potential in things, and when I see a lot of potential in stuff, I want to like excel the.
Was it always something that you said?
There was something about that company.
About I want to be.
Yeah.
Really in depth, because some people want to say on the periphery, but like, yeah, I'll be a graphic guy.
Yeah.
Or I'll be a video guy, or I'll be a cameraman, or whatever. Was it always something that you said? Nah. Fuck this. I want to be in the mix. I want to be in that.
I'd never in front of the camera personality, for sure. Like, I when I was little, I used to, like, draw a pyro at the corner of my notebook. Mm. And, like, I used to draw, like, the No Mercy stages on the corner of my notebook in, like, middle school and, like, put pyro and stuff and, like, design stages for wrestling. So I was always interested in, like, that aspect and, like, how it is to put one together, how each detail is when it comes to, like, contacting people, when it comes to... getting the right streaming service, the right connections. You know, you just
it's not easy, man.
It's not easy, and it took time. Easy. You know, it was quick though. I know like a lot of people are salty because like I'm young. You know,
don't you think you came in through the back door? Because a lot of people say that. Like I said, I was listening to Sean Oliver's his audiobook
Kayfabe,
and he was talking about how. If you're in the business, you gotta know someone, or you're connected with someone, or whatever it can be. You find your way in because of your talent. What is it? How was it that you not to say that you fucking fangled your way in, but people acknowledge your talent. What was the way that people were using you in their promotions?
Like when I started off at House of Glory, And it was like after what show? I think it was after At Last.
It was after At Last.
It was like High Intensity.
I think it was after the match.
How the fuck did you? How did you wrangle your way in? Because
so I DM'd Brian XL.
It's crazy
constantly.
It's crazy because we see you for the scene where you're a fan, and then next week it's like, dude, Isaac's fucking in the building, and I'm like, what?
Yeah.
And by the building, you mean behind the DJ area playing the music?
Yeah. It that was weird.
I
never wanted to do music. I hated it.
I remember when you told me that. I was like,
they were
really?
Like holding me back when I was at House of Glory. I'm not going to lie. Like, they held like a lot of people back with like a vision. I always had a vision, you know? Like, I keep bringing it up because like I got to be around some of the best people in the Northeast, and I got to see how things work backstage, and I realized like, you know what? Like, somebody's got to do something that's like chill, more comfortable, cuz like, for example, when I first went to House of Glory, it was like you were joining like a little mafia or something.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it was like, not a mafia, but it's like,
oh, believe me, I know.
Like a gang, you know. But,
I know.
But it's like family, like a fraternity type of thing. Mm-hmm. So it's like, oh, yo, if you're with us, you gotta be with us. You know what I'm saying? So like, I just
more of a cult.
I was there for like 5 years, a good long 5 years, and I was doing like, I started off doing like ringside like camera work, and then he made me do outside projects, but like then music and stuff, and then it was just something. I wasn't happy over there, so then literally after that's when like shit really went up. I was also
you made the connections.
I made the connections, but I wasn't really like
and lifelong
going
friends
outside.
I mean,
I'm very grateful, even though like people think like I hate Brian XL. Like, sure, like the guy could be a dick sometimes, you know. But, like,
of course,
can we all?
And I can admit it. Like, I could be the one to admit it. A lot of people are, like, they're so pussy and they don't want to say it and shit. Yo, the dude's a dick.
Factually, I'm in the same realm because I've done business.
But look how successful he is,
right?
And you see why his mindset has to be like that. And after going through what I went through last week, I'm like, yeah.
When it comes to that, I've always said that. Listen, I've done business with him. We've been in the broke bread or whatever the case may be. And I would always say that, yeah, he's a fucking asshole. He is. But he knows it, and he will acknowledge his assholeness.
Absolutely.
It's not one of those individuals to where it's like, yeah, no, that's not what I do. No, he knows what he did. There was actually an instance where we were at a venue and something happened.
Yeah, remember that?
He approached me, and it was also real asshole shit. And I'm like, dude. You told me I could do this, and he had to.
Too much going on.
You're right.
His mind's at a million places.
But that's what it takes when you make the connections with individuals in your life, because it's gonna be either, I'm gonna fuck you or you're gonna fuck me, and then you gotta work that into a tangible in your business. It's unfortunate, especially in wrestling. It's very unfortunate that it happens that way, but. Business is business. So you were the individual where you're young, you coming into the business, you're doing video, you're doing videography, you're doing graphics, you were multitasking with everything.
Yeah.
What was your first opportunity to open up to go outside of House of Glory to go anywhere else?
GCW.
Oh, okay.
Came at me like immediately once what was the show? High Intensity 5 with Enzo?
Yes.
And it was Enzo and Austin Aries, I think.
Yep.
They were on that, whatever that fucking catastrophe was. It was that show.
That mess.
Yeah, whatever the fuck that mess was.
A catastrophe.
That was like the final straw after like, you know, being straight up with Brian. And
that was the Matt Riddle mess.
Yeah,
show,
was crazy. Literally, like, I wake up and I get three messages, one from John Carlo, who was their guy that got signed by WWE that did the Janela vignettes. One was from DeMonto at the time when he worked, and one was from Brett Lauderdale. And they invited me over to, I don't remember the show, but it was like in Howell, New Jersey. It was in Jersey. And I did a music video that got like 10K automatically. And it was like Pentagon Jr. versus Joey Janela.
Right.
And they were like, this is a guy. And then they wanted me to do like more shit with them visually. And I think that was the thing that was like, it didn't hold me back moving at House of Glory, but it definitely like, it was like going to school, literally. Like, you learn everything. So like, now that I know some shit, it was like level after level, like going to promote.
Before you even go beyond that, where the fuck did you pick up this fucking talent? You didn't go to school for it.
YouTube. Oh, yeah, I never talked about it. That's a good question. YouTube. I grew up doing stop motion animation on my cell phone. It was like a really bad.
What, Legos?
I remember those videos.
They were like Jack's Figures. So I had like Undertaker, and I had Shawn Michaels and Mr. Kennedy. And I used to do stop motion music videos in like when YouTube first came out, like 2006. So I did like stop motion videos on Windows Movie Maker, really shitty. But I was also always fascinated by the presentation and the details and the hype of wrestling. Like I was always into the visual aspect of it, and everything just looked the same. And to the point, like fast forwarding to now, like everything was just looking the same. And
yeah, because yeah, and I remember, I actually remember in high school, yeah. Isaac was known as...
Oh God, I used to do Vine.
Isaac was known as the Vine, yeah. Like the, he was like the he was like the viral kid at our school with Vine. Yeah. Like he was the most creative.
I don't tell anyone about that because it died. And
it
I was
died,
like,
but
it died. And I was like, I don't want to deal with it.
It died, but on that on the California trip, we would online for the Disney, for the Universal rides, we would watch his Vines, and like the school would go up to him and like show him mad love for how creative and stupid they were. They were
just
fucking
stupid.
Hilarious.
I'm just mad stupid. Like I'm just
you
like,
know what that. Comes from, right?
I don't know where the fuck. It's probably my culture or some shit. I don't know.
You're only kid, right?
I'm only kid.
Exactly.
And that's where it's like.
That's it, because I
all you have
I
yourself
appreciate
to think.
That
because
I know
yeah.
So
yeah.
We have to do shit to entertain us.
Absolutely, and I was always fascinated
you
by
ever,
media.
You ever did like theatrical stuff?
I did theater once.
Yeah.
For
you
1 year.
The Bush and the Wizard of Oz.
Shut the fuck up. I was
He was a Bush.
A Bush.
No. I was a cop in the play Guys and Dolls.
Oh,
yes, he was.
On Look, Be a Lady Tonight. I was
there for that. Christ the
senior
King.
Year. It was my last year. I said, "Fuck it, I'm doing theater." You know, cause baseball didn't work. Baseball fucking hurt my leg, but I love baseball though. But I thought, I was like, you know what? Let me try something different. Let me go to theater.
Love Be a Lady Tonight. He nailed it because when like. With us, we need an outlet. We want attention. We need to do something.
I like creating.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And it's like a fidget kind of, because when you have like something on your mind that you keep writing that you want to bring to reality, like you actually could.
And you were literally that kid who was at home.
Yeah.
Enjoying wrestling, enjoying
watching Steve Jobs documentaries,
videos, and those shit at a young age. You were far beyond because
very old. I'm very. You gotta keep in mind, like you know, I'm old soul.
I'm
an old
say,
fucking
you're
soul.
Old soul. Everyone you guys came on that music vibe.
Yo, yeah, absolutely. Like I was grown up an old soul.
Olskey is my guy for here, and in life is my that's my little man's and everything. But Isaac is my viejo.
Yes.
That's not. He's my old man. That's not an old man.
Yeah. Everyone says that.
Yo, during the group chat, they be sharing like some old 70s groove fucking funk songs and shit. And I'm like
Earth, Wind, Fire.
And I always so mad. I said, Isaac has been raised right.
Yes,
bro.
He has. Yeah. I remember the first time.
You know what's funny is that Isaac never sat with mom. He never really sat with mom. If mom was sitting and talked to Isaac, she would love him.
Suzy Q.
Yeah.
Yeah, you already know.
Even the salsa, the old school salsa.
The whole
and all that shit.
Yeah.
But where did that come from, though?
The music taste.
Grandpa. Yeah, everything, but just everything.
I grew up in a house with...
Because how old are you?
I'm 23.
But you have a soul like a 40-year-old.
Just turned 23.
But you have a
I grew
like
up with my grandparents. My pops left me when I was...
And your grandparents is how old?
60s.
Yeah, it's around. Yeah, 60s. It's around that.
My mom's like in 40s.
Yeah, yeah, she's my age. So yeah.
And she had me like 20 years old, 19 years old, some shit like that. Yeah. But I grew up. My mom was always working, so I was like with my grandparents at their house and shit. So my grandfather always played Motown. My grandma always had fucking novellas in the background, always telling me to butcher and shit, teaching me shit like that. So yeah, she's like the only one that spoke
Put
Spanish
it on
to me.
Solido, he got
oh,
there,
you already
like
know. Oh, bro. All
El
that shit.
Chacal,
yes. My
I have no idea what you're talking
and
about.
My grandfather.
I have no idea what you guys are talking about. It sounds fun though.
You have this. You have this old-fashioned Dominican grandmother, and then you have the Puerto Rican grandfather from war.
Yeah.
My grandfather was in Desert Storm, and all he listened to was like fucking House of the Rising Sun, Horse with No Name.
Yeah.
And then it go to Motown and fucking Marvin Gaye and fucking Green Onions.
Oh my God, you have no idea.
Green Onions.
Yeah, yeah
you remember
have,
that shit.
But you know what's crazy is that you have no idea
that
it is to gravitate and grab somebody from you guys demo that knows that shit.
Yeah, I can imagine.
It's rare.
He's a rare Pokemon in this shit.
Yeah, he's like a Buffalo Nickel, man. It's crazy.
J Rose is into that too, like the same thing. Shout out to J Rose, my boy J Rose, who we'll get into
and
that
how
later,
old is he?
Like 21.
Yeah.
Yo, it's funny because
Indiana guy.
Isaac would sit there and throw me shit on, not in the group page, but he'd throw it to me personally and fucking text messages, and I would die because, like, this motherfucker, yo. It's like, he would make my day by doing that shit.
That's actually how your friendship grew, because he came over for the studio for a few times, and once you found out he was into that old school music and all the different culture.
But not only that, it's because, like I said, the kid. Like I said, he's old in soul, but it's also a thing to where, like, you guys, it's like there's something that's missing with you guys. You needed that because your livelihood, your household, there's something missing with it. And then when it happens that you guys have come to me, I was just like, yo, these fucking kids is hilarious, man. I thought y'all were cool as fuck.
Definitely, vice versa, bro.
And then when all things came together, I saw the creativity and the promise with both of you guys. But the shit with Isaac was that he really had this idea of what he wanted to do wrestling wise. He really had this promise that I'm gonna get this done.
Yep,
I'm gonna do this.
Like I said, I didn't know Isaac was into wrestling until the California trip. We were waiting at the airport, and him and Mike Marzano were watching wrestling on YouTube, Ring of Honor. And I walked over to them and said, and I was like, wait, you guys watch wrestling?
It was like Tyler Black versus Kevin Cena.
Yeah, it was like old school Ring of Honor. And but before that, I didn't know the kid liked wrestling as much as he did. He was passionate about it since even then.
And that was like fucking
But where the fuck did that crazy. Come from, though? Grandpa, grandma, and all that shit?
I started watching Monday Night Raw for my grandpa, just flicking the channel, and then he put on Lucha Libre.
But how the fuck, because it's I crazy. Know you know the old school shit as well.
I had to do the research. I did join late. Like, I'm talking like Master Lock era.
Yeah.
I started watching, like, the Ruthless Aggression kind of.
Yeah.
But you know also the past shit. Yeah. Like, you go into, like, the old school New Japan or the old school fucking. Yeah.
That was later on. Yeah. A little bit. But, like.
What'd you do? YouTube fucking is another teacher as well.
Oh, absolutely.
YouTube is
YouTube legit taught me everything.
YouTube's the dojo.
I'm on the edge of dropping out because of YouTube, because, like, everything I'm learning is on my YouTube.
But you know who says that, right? Yeah. MJF said the same shit, that he learned a lot of things because of it's a lot
YouTube
of
YouTube is probably the biggest learning. YouTube is probably the best learning tool that we have today, seriously.
You have to, like, really have fucking passion to just look at detail on little YouTube videos and stuff like that. You know what I'm saying? Like, you really have to have a hunger for it, because if you don't, it's all not worth it, because it's got to be put to no use, you know? So, like, figuring out, oh, shit, I fuck with wrestling.
Right.
I'm going to fucking go all out. I'm going to detail on how people do lower thirds and all that other shit, you know? So I was always like that. I started off making, like, SmackDown highlight reels when I was, like, 10, 13 years old.
Just for the fuck
PC,
of it.
PC, just for the fuck of it.
Yeah.
So I was always interested in media, and I always fucking watched, I always watched SmackDown fucking, what was it?
Pix 11.
The nine one. It was like My Nine or something.
My Nine. It was like Pix 11.
They fucking hip hopped everywhere, and then TNA was on Spike, and I thought it was the coolest shit.
Oh, TNA on Spike.
Because it was
the
different,
best.
And there was like a six sided ring, so that was like fascinating as fuck.
But was it always a thing to where you sat there and said, I like videography. I like doing this. I like the cinematic stuff, but maybe I could do a little bit more with it.
I think a lot of the cinematography not only came from the hype videos from like around when Rey Mysterio won the title. Yo, when Eddie died, that's probably when Eddie died, that for real stuck with me.
Big
that
time,
stuck
dude.
With me where, like, yo, I actually feel something, and it's because of this.
What, you guys were like five? Like, how
no,
old?
No.
I don't remember.
It was in 2005.
But it stuck heavy, you know. I remember that day being so important and shit. So that stuck with me. And after that, I was like looking at the video packages, and I'm like, whoa, this is so cool. I always wanted to make a movie and shit, because I love movies, and I love, like, Quentin Tarantino, Robert Rodriguez films.
Oh,
and
my
shit
God.
Like,
Isaac is the biggest fan of The Great Gatsby. Not The Great Gatsby. My bad. Wolf of Wall Street. Bro, that's like his inspiration.
You ever watch that movie?
Oh, it's one of the most inspirational movies ever. Oh, yes, my. Yes. Leonardo DiCaprio is a god. Like, he killed that film.
You should have a
By the way,
that
you
show,
know what movie you would like? I don't know if you've ever seen it. I think I've told you before that you should watch. The Whackness.
No, I've never heard of that.
That's one thing. Both of you guys.
The Whackness.
The Whackness.
WACKNESS.
The Whackness.
Okay,
you guys will, especially you will love it, because it's an old school soundtrack, and the theme of it. It's so inspirational. One day we should. I should have thought about it. We should sit and watch it together. It's a great fucking movie.
The Whackness.
But you also love the cinematography of it as well. And I also take what you've done with video and stuff, and I say that you're very connected with the old school style of doing video,
yeah.
But you also find a great spin of and intangible. It's like an intangible when it comes to the new way, because I've never seen anybody put a video together as fast as you could.
Oh, it's unreal. Unreal. Bro, me and Isaac
with audio and everything.
Bro, me and Isaac be watching Raw, and it's like at 9 o'clock, and he goes, "Yo, I'll be right back." It's like 10 o'clock, and he goes, "What do you do?"
ICW,
check ICW post. Yeah. There's a whole ass video up already. I'm like, what the fuck?
Crazy how you do
it. It's clockwork now.
I've seen it.
It's mental memory. It's clockwork.
I've seen him do it. There was times that he'd been here and goes, "Oh, I'm doing this. Click, uh-huh. click,
and he's like,
yeah. And I was,
a lot of YouTube guys.
Yeah,
honestly, I gotta be honest. Like, that's literally it.
Well, that's what's trying to teach me the graphic work and YouTube, sure.
So what was the next step? What when it came to, all right, I'm getting recognized. I'm doing name drop some guys, big name guys that you've done videos for.
Loki hit home when I did Loki's. I remember because it was a build up to Amazing Red and Loki at a House of Glory show, and like I think that was the moment where I'm like, holy fuck, this is one of my favorite wrestlers I looked up to for a very long time,
mm-hmm.
and. I felt I had to get comfortable. It was a weird feeling, and then I got used to it. Then
did you not ever meet Loki before?
I am Loki.
I don't like pepperoni, no cheese, no crust.
He's awesome.
Shinnison, if you want to do a show, I'm there for you. But you gotta make sure that everything's legit, and make sure down the line that everyone gets what they're owed. And by the way, I will stomp you in your chest if you don't make me look good.
I had to make him look good. I had to make him look good. He did say that. He told me, make me look good.
All the time.
Yeah, you got it. Yeah. Kick the shit out of me.
That's the goal, right?
Of course. And then I did the GCW gigs, and then that's when Brett Lauderdale was like, okay, I'm going to send you out to Chris Dickinson. We're going to make a Bloodsport video. And then, after I was, roll after that. And then that's kind of, when it started, getting crazy with videos.
I remember what happened was after House of Glory, Isaac went to, he did the ICW thing and GCW, but I remember a special day that Isaac was so close to getting with Impact. I remember we went to Bound for Glory.
Oh, okay, yeah, I remember that day you were talking.
And I think Isaac shot a video for Moose, did you not?
I did a commercial for their sponsor, Comda.com, and then I also helped produce the tapings from the Bound for Glory. What year was that?
It was Bound for Glory, two or three years ago.
18?
Yeah, I think so. And it was Killer Cross, too.
Killer Cross. I shot with Killer Cross. I shot with Moose. And I shot with Rascals.
The Rascals. I remember Mark.
And Susie.
I remember me, Joel, and Mark went to a local bar. And Isaac came back and said, yo, I'm speaking to the owner right now. Like, I'm getting crazy vibes right now.
I'll tell
you. They let him in the back and everything.
It was right place, right time, especially when I, told them who I worked with. I guess that was, a big deal to them for some reason. But they were like, they were like, oh, GCW, you like their shit, and, Mark and Allen shit. And they're like, okay, I want you to help produce this shit. They never paid me. TNA never paid me.
Wow. That's all right.
It's all good. It's all good.
But
so,
at the end of the day,
fuck you, Peter Dooley.
It's the experience.
Sometimes it's the experience, and you can put that on a resume. You put that up there.
Oh, it helped. It helped a lot. I've never had that many butterflies.
Dude, me and Isaac were in the
that
fucking.
That was huge.
Me and Isaac went into the stage early, and we were watching.
I took him with me the next day that he said that I'm good to go, and then I took Matt and I snuck him backstage. And then who was next to us, bro? There was Steve Mack.
Abyss. Steve Mack was next to us.
Ace Austin in catering. And he
was
doing Explosion at the time.
Yeah.
There was a ton
of
Dreamer,
guys. The funny thing was, I was like, yo, Isaac, I feel awkward now standing here. He was like, yo, go to the coffee place and just get a cup of water and act like you're drinking coffee.
Yeah, yeah. It's what they call a prop.
He goes, yo, just fucking pretend you're drinking coffee, bro.
Just go to the gimmick and look like you're good.
Yeah, I did that. We went to the coffee place.
I remember telling him the night before, yo, just wear all black and wear a hat. You'll be fine. Wear all black. Get a black fleece and you're good.
Yeah, it's funny
because Isaac will tell you that. And he'll tell me. He'll be like, listen, do me a favor. Don't be you. Relax. I know how you could be.
Remember that megaphone you picked up? Don't do that.
He said, don't do that. No.
No more megaphone.
But now you got in. You're in the, I guess the outer inner world of the wrestling, right?
Yeah.
So, in case people don't know, now you're connected and a part of a promotion that started off a little bit early on. Had its moments, was hit or miss with the crowd base.
The commentary for the damn plug.
Of course we did. Fucking yeah. Bastards.
We had commentary for the last.
Loved it though. But
loved it.
Steve Mack versus.
But now all of a sudden it becomes, you went from a cinematic dude to now you're a big part of a company of a promotion. How the fuck did that happen?
I have no idea.
No, it was so quick, dude. Like, just everything that came together in that December, because, like, Bounce and Suffering was based out of Richfield Park, New Jersey, in, like, the same building every 15 other local promotions around
the Knights of Columbus.
Yeah, the Knights of... Exactly. So, I was always interested because they always had these very different, unique cards that have that fight feel.
Right.
And I believe that at the time, that it was, like, 2017... And they were the first promotion outside of House of Glory to give Matt Travis his platform. I thought that was the coolest shit.
Right.
I remember even before Matt Travis debuted, I came to you guys. I was like, yo, watch out for Matt Travis.
And then he showed up at House of Glory student show at Elks Lodge. And everyone
who the fuck is that guy?
Meh.
Yeah. And, like, I used to be with him, like, every week, fucking training at Hog, filming him and shit. And I was like, yeah, this guy's got to be the fucking shit. So I was so... fucking hype when I saw him going to Violence and Suffering. Then he did GCW, then he was making waves at CZW and shit like that. So, like, Violence and Suffering had a special place in my heart because of that shit. And to be honest, like, the last run they had last year was, like, fucking shit. Like, I don't even want to say names, but they had someone backstage who was helping out their sponsor who's, like, I'll admit it now. I have a fucking sponsor. I'll be one of the first promoters to admit it. I really don't care. I have a sponsor for my events. I book it. He backs me up 100%, and it goes back. And
it's usually
business.
A team thing like
and
that.
And at the
though.
End of the day, it's business. So, just want to say that because a lot of people are pussy to say that. Anyways, he was just bad at booking shows, and there would legit be like 10 fucking people there. And I'm like, well, dude, you could easily like switch up. You know, I know how to build a card now with like being around, you know, all these other DeMano and fucking Lauderdale and shit.
Yeah.
I was with Lauderdale when he was fucking riding Bloodsport, so I understand how.
I remember that shit.
I remember, yeah. I sent, yeah, like I took a photo and I posted it on my story. I was like, I know how to format shows. Give me a chance. I really would love to check it out. And we had the first show. They were like, okay, you do one show good and the company's yours and shit. So the show was called Violence of the Lambs. And it was scheduled for March, but that hit right before. It was the week before Mania weekend.
Yeah.
And COVID just happened.
Yeah.
So I'm like, fuck.
I remember.
I was so fucking sad. Wow.
I remember the first week of COVID got bad.
I remember Danny DeMano like, yo, we're still running.
I remember because.
I was like, what?
The idea is that you pitched for us and we was like, dude, this shit is going to be fucking fun.
It's going to be insane.
It's going to be hilarious. It's going to be great.
Insane. And, yeah. And I wouldn't. I again, like I said, like it was literally given to me because someone backed out. You know, I'll say it, Pinky Sanchez backed out of his position. And he literally, in my face, did an agreement in front of our guy Orlando. And he's like, listen, the company's yours. Run with the ball, be the booker. If it works out, it's yours. You know, so, like, I saved some time. I put some money as well. I wanted to help out because, obviously, it wasn't being treated seriously before.
Right.
So I wanted to offer something that's, like, fucking cool vibes, you know? Like, just good fucking people wrestling and matches ever, you
but
know?
But then COVID hits, and then it's like, okay.
COVID hits, you
we
know?
We got to pull it back. But I think when... Everybody sits there and they say that COVID was a disaster for many, which it was.
In March,
But creatively,
yes.
You pull out
give you more time.
Yes.
Something and it gives you more time to pull out something.
Yes.
Which I have to say that the premise that's out with VXS now is something that it's very magnetic to wrestling fans and also people outside alike. Your promos, your videos and all that is very in tune with what the day and age is.
Yeah.
Just quickly, so like I just give a quick synopsis. It's like, if you love video games, you love fighting games, you love the fucking the
Mortal Kombat, Tekken.
You love the action games or the case may be. The premise of that is so fucking. You gravitate to that.
And it's a good point you say that, because it's like little visuals like that that you see, but you don't see anyone else doing it.
Right.
You question, wow, why isn't anyone capitalizing with such a great, like such a blessing of having their own promotion? I always asked that since day one, and as a kid I was like, yo, that would be so cool. Imagine like if fucking Tony Hawk meets trap music meets wrestling.
Right.
That sounds so awesome.
So I was like, you know, I gotta do something for the boys, because these guys are like the fucking.
Because they are in the same field.
That's what it is.
They love the same.
Yes, exactly. And like, it's very nostalgic. A lot of the guys listen to the same fucking music, the same fucking style. You can see in the video edits we had my boy Abdullah, he helped out a lot in the vignettes we did with like Gresham and Tony and all that shit. But
I can't wait to see people steal your shit.
The key is adapting.
I can't wait to see people steal your shit.
Absolutely, and it's already pirated, and I fucking downloaded it. So, anyways, I fucking support it. Anyways, I think the reason of not only the envy we're getting, but also the overwhelming positivity is because of how well we're adapting to the community and also our generation of wrestling. And I think that has to do a lot with the fast upcoming that the company's getting right now.
Is it because of the company is, I guess it's a new idea or a new
presentation.
Presentation.
It's a new visual presentation
of what wrestling is, or the fact that you think that this is, people will think of it as like a passing fad or something like that. Because what I look at it is that I'm not the type of dude that sits there to support bullshit. I will not support bullshit.
Yeah.
I'll be like, listen, if you don't show me anything that's going to be legitimate for the long run, I'm not going to sit there and give you love. This shit right here is something that I feel that you guys could tap into a longevity. Did you really feel that you doing this was going to be a hit or miss? Did you feel that this could be a
100%.
Yeah, right?
It was a fucking risk.
Yeah.
It was a risk, honestly. It still is a risk. Like, you live and you learn and you go through all these things and you just got to accept stuff.
But
and
you got the wrestlers who loved it. You got guys.
That's because we got the perfect team, honestly. And with the connections I made and we all know the type of vibe we all want to bring, not just to wrestling, but especially like our home of Northeast wrestling. It was the shit. Everyone involved in this. We're fans of the Jersey All Pro era. We're fans of that early ICW grit that everyone was just innovating, having fucking amazing matches, and that's something that's very lost art, very repetitive in our area, and especially Philly. There wasn't wrestling in Philly like in half of this entire year, and the fact like to have my first show in Philly is like a dream come true.
Well, Isaac, let me ask you. I mean, I remember the first time you spoke about this. We were playing Call of Duty, and you told me.
We were playing Call of Duty.
I swear to God.
We're having conversations over
Call of Duty.
Like,
we're playing Modern Warfare,
and all of a sudden he goes, bro, VXS, it's mine. I'm like, shit. He goes,
yeah, I got the text.
First thing he says is, I'm thinking X Games, Tony Hawk.
X Games meets wrestling, baby.
And
yep.
And this, from the second I heard that, that hit me. Let me ask you, from the beginning, what's the one thing that the Northeast wrestling scene has missed that you try incorporating into your product? Because we see the ICWs, the GCWs, the death matches are aplenty in the Northeast scene. What was the goal from the beginning to stand out from just being another death match company or what the Northeast has been doing for the past decade? Because a lot of things have been missed.
Listening to the fans. That's the easiest answer I could give you right now.
And what are the fans? What were the fans paying for?
Because you learn, you see around what isn't there. And you also look at the history and you go through the roots of your peers and you say, hey, how was this early 2000 Ring of Honor show was, and why was the crowd so hype? And just think differently. Like, it really has to do with like speaking to the fans like they're your friends.
Yeah.
Like, you have to have a relationship with your fans. And if you don't, your complete following is not going to succeed.
Yeah.
A lot of people talk online, especially like they're fucking bosses or they're different. In reality, nobody's fucking special. Like, the fans are just important. So, like, just speaking to the fans, I think, is the biggest separation from VXS and every other company right now.
And the thing is, you say that the fans matter. And I think you and even a former member of ICW, Jack, said it perfectly on the show a few weeks ago when he joined on our live. the Northeast wrestling scene missed wrestling. Wrestling.
There's a big void to fill.
There's a void to fill, and I'm sorry. And I think Red, you could agree with me on that. No, we've been saying it for years now. We're missing the old school Ring of Honor kind of style. We haven't seen that in I don't know fucking how long. So
early 2000s, like.
So I guess that you did listen because that shit is missed, especially for me. I know you because you don't like death matches that much, Red. And the companies are being afloat.
I'll be
on
honest.
That.
I'm not big on death match wrestling. I could accept it. And I think it's fucking awesome at points, but then there's some points of the match where I'm like, that's a little...
See, what you did on your show was great. It was one match. It was, I can't even say
it. Alex Ocean versus Jeff King, and they did like a gusset plate spot in the forehead, and I was just, oh, God. It was gnarly for sure.
Guys, let me just drop a promo for this. It's, if you guys check out the Fight app, go on Fight, check out Violence and Supper and VXS.
Turnbuckle Tabloid.
3, 2, 1
Turnbuckle Tabloid.